it's important that we have a good retirement fund.
As a retiree, I'm very active. I do campaigns.
In my spare time, I enjoy volunteer work.
I do art, one class. I do knitting.
I don't stay in the house. I'm out of the house.
If I didn't have a good retirement, or my husband didn't have a good retirement, we would not be able to do half of the things that we do now. We can travel. We can pick up and jump into the car as high as gas is today. We can jump in the car and take long trips because we have the funds to do so.
My mother has a retirement plan, and she's actually doing very well for herself because she prepared herself. And actually, she's the one that guided me when I started working, that I need to prepare myself for that day to come.
What's happening now is so many families, so many working families are being sandwiched. They're having to take care of both their aging parents and their children who are coming up, and that's going to seriously hinder their ability to spend and take part in the economy in the future.
My mother-in-law lives with my wife and I because she cannot afford to live on her own. She has no retirement plan. All she receives is her Social Security benefits, and which is not enough to live on.
Having to rely on family, especially your children, it takes away your independence.
It wouldn't work out for me at all. I wouldn't feel right about it. I feel that I should have my own and not be a burden on my kids.
I think when I look at people who lack access to a retirement plan now, it is a derivative of a lack of bargaining power. I think the solution is activism.
I have grandchildren. I have two great grands. And I'm just wondering, what will be there for them?
My hopes for my daughter's future is I want her to be able to make a good living and have security for when she retires, that she can take care of herself financially.
Certainly, I would like to see my grandchildren, even my great-grandchildren, to accomplish even more than I have accomplished.
See them become, you know, independent young ladies on their own, with good jobs, security, benefits, something they can stand and be proud of.
I love New York, but it is so hard to survive here. Working, I'm scared to death what we'll do, you know, for people that can't work anymore and don't have a retirement fund.
Every worker
deserves to retire
with dignity.
Dignity.
With dignity.
That was the first time I saw that, and I'm very proud that I could have helped some of the narrative. My name is Teresa Gilarducci. I've been here for 6 years, and I've waited 6 years to convene a meeting in this room with my students, with my fellow faculty members, with the labor movement in New York City, and with everyone else who has come here today who has helped design high-performance pension plans. Thank you very much for coming this morning. I'm very, very happy to see you. I also want to welcome our esteemed political leaders who are voters in our democratic process have entrusted you with our futures, with our economic futures, and with our retirement futures. So thank you very much for coming. I am Teresa Gilarducci. I'm the director of the Schwartz Center for Economic Policy Analysis. We are the policy arm of the Department of Economics at the New School for Social Research at the New School. So welcome here to my school. We are dedicated as our policy arm to incorporate what we do as academics with our graduate students and with our faculty members, which is to provide a critical analysis of mainstream economic thinking. And we aim to incorporate that critical economic framework into mainstream policymaking. And our retirement income security project is a way to push forward research that also has very practical policy aims. We're dedicated to the principle that every civilized society, and that includes New York City, provides adequate retirement security income for all people who have worked a lifetime in a dignified job. So it's not separating our aims to improve the quality of work for everyone who works for a living, but also to make sure that dignified quality of life extends into retirement. So it's my pleasure today to introduce my new colleague, my new friend, Vinny Alvarez, who has a distinguished career in the labor movement. He worked for 17 years in one of my favorite unions. I used to work for a local out in California for the IBEW. Not to distinguish between all the other unions that are represented here. You're all my favorite union, right? He was elected in 2011 for a four-year term as the president of the Central Labor Council. You all might know that. This is called the Central Labor Council of New York, the Central Federation. He has previously served at the state Fed level as assistant legislative director, where he provided a lot of initiatives that, of course, deal with worker security. He has active in a number of programs on behalf of the union, particularly around political campaigns, grassroots initiatives where successful political campaigns happen, and he has done what unions have always done, which is negotiate really good contracts for their members. So thanks very much, Vinny.
Thank you, and thank you all. Thank you all for being here. Thank you, Teresa. Thank you to the Schwartz Center for Economic and Policy Analysis, and I'd like to welcome you all to this very important and I think discussion that is long overdue for us to have here in New York City. And I really want to thank all the panelists, our elected officials, our state comptroller Tom DiNapoli for being here, elected officials, our business leaders, and so many good people who went into doing the work for this event today. The CLC staff, along with the Schwartz Center, has worked extraordinarily hard, and I want to thank them for all the work that they've done. Just very briefly, because you're going to hear so much information that's critical to this topic today, but for far too long, I think we've danced around really getting into this issue. And, you know, I'm very proud of the fact that when it comes to retirement security, 70% of the unionized workforce here in the city, you know, they have the benefit of a retirement plan. But unfortunately, there's far too many who are being left behind. Unfortunately, as you'll see in the statistics, when 59% of the city workforce does not have either a 401k plan or a pension plan, it is a crisis. It's not just an issue that needs to be discussed, but it's a crisis that requires an in-depth discussion and some solutions from all the stakeholders that we have in this room here today. I just think that when you step back away for a moment, and we all know and we love and we live and work in this city, and we know how expensive it is to live in this city, but it goes beyond just New York City, it goes throughout this country. And when you talk about the average retirement Social Security benefit of $15,000, such a diminished level of savings that people have in personal savings of $10,000 on average or less, it's unsustainable from an economic standpoint. But it goes beyond this, because this is not just an economic issue and an economics question, but this is actually a moral dilemma and a moral issue for this country. You know, many, many years ago, I mean, I think we have a lot of inspiration, many of us, as we go through our professional careers. And very early on, when I was a college student back in the 80s, I remember reading about Hubert Humphrey, and a quote that always stayed with me with him was that, you know, the moral test of government is how they take care of those in the dawn of their life, the children, those in the twilights of their life, the age, and those that are in the shadows of society, in the shadows of the life, the sick, the needy, and the handicapped. And I think that when we look at this issue of retirement security, of the ability of every single worker in this country and in this city, that we need to focus on the fact that every worker, all workers, unionized workers, non-unionized workers, every worker is deserving to retire in dignity and with respect after a lifetime of work. So it gives me great pleasure to be part of this, and along with the Schwartz Center, to host this today. And I want to specifically thank Teresa Ghilarducci for her guidance, for all of the expert advice that she gives us on a daily basis, and for all of the Central Labor Council Executive Board members who we have these discussions, who are here today. I want to make one note for one of them who is on the panel today. Of course, Dr. Barbara Bowen, who is with us, who will be on the second panel. I want to thank you, Barbara, for taking the time out to be with us as well, and all the panelists. With that in mind, I want to introduce our next speaker. And as you know, this is a broad labor movement, a big labor movement, and we are very, very fortunate that in the state of New York, we have in the leadership capacity, my dear friend and colleague, Mario Salento. Mario and I talk, as we always say, on a daily basis, on a weekly basis, and constantly on big picture issues, and also on issues affecting us on a day-to-day basis. And I can't tell you how proud I am to work with him and call him not only a colleague and a friend, so it's my pleasure to introduce Mario and thank you for all the work that he does, our president, Mario Salento.
Thank you, Vinny. Thank you very much. Let me just say, if I can, about Vinny for a second. I'm going to take 1 minute. Vinny represents 1 million members here in New York City, 400 local union affiliates. And there becomes, in that sort of job, a day-to-day grind of what you have to do with the short-term goals of your affiliates and making sure that all that work gets done every single day. But Vinny has this unique ability to look long-term, to look to long-term initiatives and solving long-term problems. And the best evidence of that is the fact that we're all here today. And Vinny, for putting this together and what you do each and every day for this city and this state, not just the 2.5 million members of the state AFL-CIO, but all working men and women in this city and this state owe you a debt of gratitude for what you do each and every day for each and every one of them. Let's hear it really now for Vinny Alvarez. Let me, I'm going to cut to the chase. I know you have a lot of great speakers today. This is what we're fighting for today, as I see it. I think it's always best to give a personal example. My father was a union member of Local 3, the IBEW. He had a good, there you go. Good job. He had a pension. He had long-term security. He was very active, and he always wanted to be able to give something back to his union. He felt very strongly about it. He volunteered for every assignment, every rally, every detail. He coordinated the Labor Day parade here in New York City for 10 years. He did all these different things. And he tried to explain to my sister and myself as we were growing up why he wanted to give something back to his union. And he would explain to us, we'd sit around the dinner table with my parents and my sister and I, and he'd say, I want to give something back to my union because it's not just about, my union is not just about me, it's about my family, it's not just about the present, it's about the future. That's a lot for a 10-year-old to really gather. It really is. My sister was 8 at the time. But as we grew up and as we grew older, I sort of tried to get a little bit more of a better understanding of it. And then when I became a union member myself, I'm a member of the CWA, Communication Workers of America, at 21, I started to really sort of gather and understand what he meant. When I really, really understood what he meant, when I really got it, unfortunately, didn't really occur until he passed away. When he passed away, my father left a really sizable, nice-sized pension to my mother. My mother had a much smaller pension of her own, and then eventually with Social Security, she was able to really live her retirement years for the years that she lived after my father passed away any way that we would all want to live it, with dignity, with self-respect, and a real measure of independence. She was able to do all the things that you would want to do in your retirement years. She was able to go to movies with her friends, go to dinner with her friends. She was able to spoil her 5 grandchildren, 5 granddaughters, Christmas presents, birthday presents, presents for the sake of presents. She never had to ask either myself or my sister for a dime, ever. And we would have been more than happy to give her anything that she wanted or needed, but she didn't. She didn't need it. When it really completely hit home for me as to exactly what my father meant all those years ago when he said it's not, you know, my union's not just about me, it's about my family, it's not just about the present, it's about the future, was last July. Last July, my mother passed away. So She passed away, and my sister and I, at that point, were eligible for a death benefit coming from my father's annuity funds, money that he had put away through his union through the years. It wasn't a life-changing amount of money. I couldn't buy a house or a car or anything like that. But it was enough money that my wife and I had to sit down and decide exactly what we wanted to do with it. It was just enough to have that discussion. I couldn't get away with anything. So we decided, we have three young daughters, we'll put whatever it is, we'll just put it away towards college. The day that it exactly hit me what my father meant all those years ago was the day that I got the first check, I signed the back of it, took the deposit slip, and went to the bank. My father became a union member around 1965. My daughter, my oldest daughter, Grace, is 11 years old. She's in fifth grade. She's going to start college in 7.5 years from now, 2021. 1965, 2021, that's 56 years. That's over a half century. Over a half century after my father became a union member, before money was started to put away for his pensions and his annuities, more than a half century later, in some small way, in a small way, my father is going to help to pay for that first year of college for my daughter, his granddaughter, a granddaughter, mind you, that he never met. That's what today is about. It's about that individual. It's about what they can do and the self-respect that they have in their own retirement. In my father's case, he never reached retirement age. But it's also about that family. It's about the support that they get. And they're able to live their lives, not just those individuals, but their families, and in some cases, generation after generation. That's what today is about, and that's why, Vinny, what you've done today to put this together so we can begin to address that 59% of those who don't have a retirement plan is so crucial. So with that, my real reason for being up here today is to introduce the first guest speaker, and you could not think of a better speaker to start this conversation this morning. You know, Tom DiNapoli is the controller of the state of New York, has many responsibilities, but we know that Tom certainly oversees the Common Retirement Fund, and under Tom's leadership, his stewardship, it is now at, a historic record level, over $176 billion, and it's continued to grow under Tom's leadership. And, you know, that money is used, obviously, for the retirement of our public sector workers, but in addition to that, we use it as an investment vehicle so that we can create new jobs and generate revenue for other working men and women in other sectors, whether it's the private sector or the building trades when we talk about investing in infrastructure and those initiatives. So Tom is the perfect person to really discuss today and bring to us his experience and his guidance as to how we can move forward and address this very important issue. And, you know, I know I've heard Tom speak many times, and Tom understands this issue certainly from a professional level, but I know also on a personal level, Tom's father also was a member of CWA. And talks about how he continues to receive a pension check every month. And I just want to say today is sort of like, a full circle day today, Tom. I know Tom graduated from the new school, the Milano School. And so, Tom, it is so appropriate that you're here with us today to begin this discussion. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor, my distinct honor and privilege to introduce to you the Controller for the State of New York, Tom DiNapoli.
Thank you, Mario. Good morning, everyone. What a great turnout. Powerful, smart people here. It's great to see you. And thank you, Mary, for that great introduction. Thank you, Vinny, for I don't know how many weeks ago saying, DiNapoli, you better be in New York City on the morning of June 17th. We've got something big going on. And it absolutely has come together beautifully. So again, my compliments to you, Vinny, for inspiring this, and certainly to Teresa Ghilarducci and the team here at the New School. And I must just say, as a quick aside, when you read in the national media about, you know, the death knell for organized labor, and then you see the leadership we have here in New York City, New York State, with Vinny Alvarez and Mario Salento, isn't it great to be in a state where union leadership is alive and well and strong and vibrant and young? Thank you both for your extraordinary leadership. So many great advocates, academics, union people who are here, civic leaders. I know my friend Bill Samuels is here, who's been sounding the alarm on this issue for a very, very long time. I know you're going to have a number of my colleagues in elective office who will be coming through. I certainly want to state again my thanks, everyone said it already and will continue to say it, to Teresa Ghilarducci, the New School, the Schwartz Center, for being such an incredible resource on this issue of retirement security, and of course for hosting us in such a magnificent way. As Mario said, and I had a little bit of flashback coming into this building, because I used to fight downstairs to get into, before you did things online, you had to stand online and fill out cards and fight to get into, but I had a great experience here at the New School. In fact, I went here so long ago, it was pre-Milano. It was called, the acronym was GISMUMP, Graduate School for Management and Urban Profession. So I date myself. He said, oh, you went to Milano. I said, well, no, actually, I went to GISMUMP at the time. But it's a great place, always has been, and no surprise that we're being hosted here. Now, I certainly have been talking about this issue. Many of you have heard me speak about retirement security before, often here, by the way, at the New School and other events that Teresa and the center have sponsored. So probably no surprise, given all the issues that we have to contend with, we're still having to talk about the need to address this issue. As you know, part of my focus always starts with a discussion of where we're at with our own DB plan, because you know, one of the big challenges that I've had as trustee of the New York Common Retirement Fund and the other pension trustees who are here in the current environment is having to explain why it's so important for us to continue to maintain the well-funded and well-run DB plans that we have. And that is an important context to our discussion today, is that many of us have been arguing we should not only be defending the DB plans, we have to recognize there are many people in our own city, our own state, that do not have access to these kinds of benefits, and we need to be talking about how we're going to deal with their issues, so it's not just a discussion of the race to the bottom, but a broader discussion about retirement security. So I appreciated Mario's mentioning it. We had a 13% positive return last year. We're now at $176.2 billion. That is our highest level that we've ever been at, and it certainly shows that we've come a long way from that loss in 1 year in 08 and 09 of 26% loss for the fund now to being at an historic high. We are funded now at about 90%. As you know, that's a very strong funded status for any pension plan. We're the best funded of all the big state plans, one of the best funded of all the state plans in the country. Last year, we were able to, press didn't report it very much, but we were able to decrease the contribution rate we charge to government employers. I'm hoping that we're going to be able to do that again this year when we announce the rates around Labor Day. So it really, our story, which again, you know, the stories that you more typically read are about New Jersey and Illinois and states that are very poorly funded. 5 minutes, I just started. I was told 15, I didn't use 10 minutes yet. Our plan is certainly an answer that, in fact, well-funded pension plans are sustainable for the long term, are secure for our not only our retirees of today, but those who will be retirees 20, 30, 40 years from now. My goal was to set the context for the discussions that are going to follow. I will try to do that in somewhere between 5 and 10 minutes. The statistics that I know you've heard some of, and I'll just reiterate them as we lead into the discussion, are of a great concern. It does show that we are in a crisis right now. The number of private sector employees who have defined benefit plans decreased from 38% in 1980 to 14% in 2010. We know those numbers continue to go down. Close to 50% of the 79 million baby boomers, 34 million men and women are at risk of not being able to maintain their living standards in retirement. An average working age household only has $3,000 saved for retirement. 38 million working age households, 45% of American households, do not own any retirement asset savings at all, whether in a 401k plan or in their own IRA. We are talking about, depending on how you calculate it, between 7 and 14 trillion dollars lacking in retirement income that people are going to need. The Schwartz Center obviously has put out stats for our own community here in New York City. 74% of low-income earners in the city making $30,000 or less have no retirement savings or plans at all. So this is very clearly an issue that we have to confront. Social Security in and of itself cannot provide retirement security. We know that 401ks are no substitute for pensions. We certainly know family structures have changed and families cannot always take care of their older members. So it's an issue that we have to confront. And we're all going to be living a lot longer. We know the numbers. Those living past 90 will grow from 1.9 million today to more than 9 million by 2050. That's good news, but it means we're going to be needing more and more retirement income. So the challenge for today is that we talk so much about the underemployed in today's economy. We're going to be talking about the under-retired as we face future generations. And that issue of retirement poor and what that's going to mean is one not only of personal impact, personal devastation for individuals and families, it also affects our city, our state, and our national economies. We like to talk about the fact that 80% of the retirees from our state plan continue to live in New York State, generating an estimated $7.4 billion in spending, $10.4 billion in economic activity, over $1.4 billion in property taxes paid. The National Institute for Retirement Security calculated, based on 2009 figures for the New York State Common Plan, State Teachers Plan, and the five New York City plans, that the retirement benefits that the retirees that continue to live in our city and state, that money staying in our local economies drives over $33 billion in economic output and results in over $5 billion in federal, state, and local taxes being paid. So we need to look at this retirement security issue not only as one that has an impact directly on individuals and families, but it has an impact on our city and our state economy, because in ways that we don't give full credit, those retirement benefits staying in our state, it's an important stabilizing impact on our economy. Mario mentioned my dad. He turned 90 in April, so he's one of those statistics now, and he's still living in the home that he and my mom built after the war and after they married, because that old three-legged stool is still working for him. Personal savings, Social Security, and a modest defined benefit pension. The reality is that three-legged stool is not there for most Americans today, and that's why we have to come up with new strategies. We can't be idealistic and assume that companies are now going to reverse the trend and put back in place the traditional DB plans, but we know there are alternatives out there. NCPERS Secure Choice proposal, Senator Harkin's Retirement Funds Act. President Obama, I was hoping he would have done it sooner, but he did this year in the State of the Union, talk about the MyRA, another approach with a government-backed option for savings. We know there is legislation pending at the federal level. We know states are looking at this issue. California's Secure Choice options that are being considered in Connecticut, Maryland, Minnesota. So here are the questions, and I will start to wrap up now, that I suggest to pose our discussion as we continue the morning. Obviously, the first one is, what do we need to do to preserve the DB plans that we have and address that larger issue of those who are not covered by these plans? And what is our goal? What is the solution? Do we renew, as part of this this approach, a serious effort at the federal level? Because I do think a case can be made that that obviously would be the optimal approach, given what is happening or what's not happening in Washington. That's the problem with the federal effort right now. As New Yorkers, do we wait and see the experience in some of the states that have already dipped their toe in the water on this issue? Or do we come up with New York-specific approaches right now? How do we consider the impact of ERISA if we come up with a New York State or New York City option? Do we have not just a state option, but we start with a New York City option as a way to begin the discussion in our state? What should be the role of the New York City public pension plans or the New York State or the teacher's retirement plan in this discussion? What's the timing of all of this? And how do we keep a priority on whatever vehicle we propose that has an ease of enrollment, protects principal, has low-cost fees, and does provide some level of guarantee for income at retirement? These are just some of the key questions that I think we need to come up with some answers. It's very clear that it's a complex issue, but we have a lot of smart people in the room here that I know have been looking at this issue, have been considering some of those options. The reality is we're at a point, because it is a crisis, where we can't afford to stand still. We can't afford to do nothing. And when you look at the history of New York State, you certainly look at the long history of when we created our public pension plans back when Al Smith was governor. New York has never been afraid about being a leader on these kinds of issues. So I look forward to working with each and every one of you to coming up with some concrete solutions at the end of today's discussion. Thank you.
Well, that was a call to action. You might have to act also. Exactly. No, we'll probably need some concrete solutions. We have a handout that says that seven states have actually taken action. We are a big enough city that we actually may be acting like a state. So that's exactly why we're here today. The next speaker I'm very honored to introduce will help set the stage about what the problem is. And you all know that before we start talking about a solution, we have to really understand the contours of the problem, the victims of the problem, and the causes of it as well. So it's my pleasure to introduce my colleague, James Parrott. He is an economist like us. He is the director, though, of the Fiscal Policy Institute that is dedicated doing research and outreach on the state of the economy and how it affects working people. He, with the center, has dealt with many advocacy organizations, including labor unions, community groups, but dedicated to collect the research that we all need to move forward. And what I really like about the description of the Fiscal Policy Institute is that you have an aim to create a prosperous New York City and New York State, but one in which the prosperity is shared by everyone. So thanks very much, Jim. And okay. You have 10 minutes.
Okay. Good morning. Thanks, Teresa. Thanks to Vinny for organizing this. Mario, controller, city controller, will be here soon. You can't start the clock on me yet. May need some help here. Let's see if I can close that. Let me get back here. This is my orientation here. Okay. I think I got it. Yep. It's great. Okay, now you can start the clock. On the point about New York City being a large economy, New York City, the size of New York City's economy is larger than that of 45 states. So, you know, I think that it's entirely appropriate that we're talking about New York City taking serious action to address its economic challenges in a lot of ways, ranging from minimum wage to retirement security, paid sick leave, and so on. In setting the economic context, I want to review just a couple of the well-known dimensions of the New York City economy before getting into the aging of the workforce and the population in New York City and looking at what the current picture for retirement income types looks like in New York. We all know that this has been the weakest recovery since the 1930s. The U.S. economy just last month reattained its employment level before the peak. Now, New York City has been doing better than the U.S. We're a little bit ahead of where we were before, but keep in mind that our labor force and population and working age population has grown over that time. Unemployment, the official unemployment rate in New York City is still 7.5%. A lot more people are, twice as many people are working part-time involuntarily as were before the recession started. And we have a serious long-term unemployment problem. Half of the people unemployed have been unemployed for more than 6 months, and a quarter of the people unemployed have been unemployed for more than a year. With unemployment at around 7.5%, in any other economic recovery period since World War II, this would be considered a recession-level unemployment. And here we are 6 years after the recession started, and we still have recession-level unemployment. In recent years, we've seen a pretty significant decline in median family income in New York City and the U.S. It's been a little steeper in New York City. Effectively, the median family income has dropped by $5,000, from $60,000 to $55,000. The poverty rate, this is the official federal poverty rate, which we know understates the true extent of poverty in New York City, has risen by 3 percentage points in New York City, greater than the increase at the national level. Most of our job growth, as we know, has been concentrated in low-wage jobs. Half of the job growth we've had since the recovery started have been in industries where the average wage is less than $30,000. So it's not just that a lot of our job growth is low wage. You know, half of it is really low wage. We face, you know, Teresa talked about the mission of FPI to promote broadly shared prosperity. We haven't exactly been succeeding at that mission in recent years. We have a pronounced lack of broadly shared prosperity in New York City. We know that over the last, you know, since 1990, there's been pretty significant overall growth in the New York City economy, about 2% a year, 2.5% a year, 60% growth in real per capita economic output in New York City since 1990, but a decline in median family income, decline in median hourly wages, and of course this shows the 1% share of the income. So a lot of this growth has been accruing to people at the very top. When you look at the population projections in New York City, you can see this very pronounced aging of the population. At the end of 2013, the city planning department released their population projections for New York City for the next 30 years. And this shows the age distribution of those projections. Each bar represents a 2010, 2020, 2030, and 2040 in that order. The top bar, you can see 65 and older. You can see the pronounced growth in the elderly population in New York City. That segment will grow by 40% over the next 30 years compared to a 10% overall increase in the city's population. That means that the elderly share of the population will go from something like 12% to 16% over that time. This is reflected in an aging of the workforce. So here, we look at a slightly different set of age groups. We take the 55 and older category at the top. This is just over the last 6 years. So this has basically been the recession and the recovery period. A 30% increase in older workers during this time, much greater than the increase in 25 to 34-year-old. And we've actually seen a decline in the labor force in the two middle age categories during that time. And of course, you know, given the previous slide, we would expect that this trend is going to continue for some time, for many, many years, if not decades. In thinking about retirement income, of course, the bedrock of that is Social Security, which has done a lot in this country to bring down elderly poverty. It's done a lot to bring down poverty overall, and it's a real success story in that regard. In the traditional retirement discussion of income, you know, we have the three-legged stool with Social Security, income from a pension or retirement plan, and income from savings. 24% of New York City households receive Social Security, on average, a little over $15,000, and it's been particularly important for low-income households, and we'll see that in a couple of slides. So Social Security has been the bedrock, and it's made a lot of difference. In an ideal world, we would be talking about how to expand Social Security and the protections that it provides. But in the meantime, we need to do something about the other two legs. So we've seen a significant decline in employer-provided pensions, and, you know, the data show that most households have very little in the way of savings that they can draw upon as an income source to help out in retirement. So here we have a couple of slides based on data from the American Community Survey that look at sources of income for elderly households, where the household head is 65 or older in New York City. So the top one is the supplemental security income, which if you're disabled, you can receive that. The amounts look pretty low on average because a relatively small percent of households receive SSI. And then there's investment income, retirement income from, the investment income would be from savings, retirement income would be from a pension or a retirement plan, and then Social Security. This first slide looks at it in terms of we have all, and then we have it broken out by race and ethnicity. And you can see that while it's true that, white households receive a little bit more than Black, Hispanic, and Asian households in Social Security, there's really a clumping effect there, which is much more equitable than what you see when you look at retirement or investment savings. And investment savings, you can really see that those are heavily concentrated in the white population. And so in the communities of color, have much less access to retirement income and very little in the way of investment income from savings. This takes the same data source and cuts it by looking at quintiles of household income, with the top bar representing the highest quintile, which, if you read the footnote there, it's the cutoff level is $105,000 for that. So you can see that investment income highly concentrated in the wealthiest 20% of households. And even the receipt of pension and retirement income is highly concentrated among high-income people. Again, when you cut it by income quintile, there's much more of a clumping effect for Social Security. So it's much more of a leveler or an equalizer. Greater disparities in income from retirement and vast disparities in income from savings. This chart shows the decline in the percent of workers who have employer-provided pensions. This data is for New York State versus the United States. You can see this long-term decline. It used to be that New York had a greater percent of its workforce covered by pensions than in the U.S. That hasn't been true now for the last several years. Just in wrapping up, just to summarize some of the key facts about retirement insecurity in New York City. We talked about the aging of the population and the implications of that for the workforce, with a lot of older workers being forced to stay in the workforce longer in order to have some wage income to supplement the fact that many of them lack a retirement plan or have very little in the way of savings to fall back on. That, of course, complicates the labor market and reduces opportunities for younger workers and middle-aged workers. Decline in employer-provided pensions, and increasingly the employer-provided pensions take the form of defined contribution rather than defined benefit plans. Great disparities in retirement income and access to retirement plans by race. And also in terms of savings, great disparities between whites and households of color in terms of the amount of savings and the ability to turn to that as an income source. And finally, Social Security is a critical form of retirement income for all households. So the policy conclusions that I know the next two panels are going to say more about, the most important thing is to protect and expand Social Security, but what can be done at the New York City and New York State level? We need to maintain public and private sector pensions and hold on to the extent that we can, defined benefit versus defined contribution plans. And I think the time is right, certainly that the motivating factor in organizing this conference is that it's time to start examining whether or not we could have some locally managed, locally operated retirement security supplemental system. Thank you.
All right, so the stage is set for our next panel. I would like to invite our panelists up to the table. We have representatives from all the stakeholders that come together to create pension plans for us. We have a representative of the financial industry sector. Anne-Marie Petok is the senior managing director for BlackRock Solutions, one of the largest asset management firms in the country, right? You now are bigger than you know who, Goldman. Come on up, Anne-Marie. She was the chief financial officer at the Ford Motor Company before coming to BlackRock, and helped design their pension systems too, which is primarily a defined benefit system. Steve Kreisberg, my colleague and friend, of the director of collective bargaining, but much, much more for the American Federation of State, County, and Municipal Employees. Again, the labor movement before Social Security was established as a key player in creating high-performance pension plans. And my other colleague, Dorian Walker, hello. Warren, sorry, an assistant professor in the Department of Political Science at Columbia University, has had a very, very, despite his young age, a very illustrious career as an academic and as an activist working with labor unions. He writes on inequality, you've heard of it, and how it dovetails with American politics. Now remember, you're in school and we have handouts. There won't be a test, but I'm thinking about it. For this panel, you might want to orient yourself around this handout. We're very proud of this handout. The researchers at SEPA worked for years on this handout. This is an update. I'd like to introduce Lauren Schmitz, who was one of the first research assistants. Where are you, Lauren? There she is, that cranked this out 2 years ago, I remember, at 106-degree weather. This is data that supplements Jim's data on New York City, not just New York State. And it actually helps document set the stage for, and I'm not exaggerating, the upcoming retirement crisis in New York City. So thanks very much. We want to leave time for questions and answers from the audience. So Anne-Marie, if you'd start, and then we'll just go down the panel.
Okay, you know, it was good listening this morning because I think the stage of the, can you hear me? Okay, let's try this. Can you hear me now? Okay, good. So I think this morning framed the problem really well. And the fact is that most people out there don't have the benefit of having the appropriate savings for retirement. And just to put this into perspective, we at BlackRock, we've designed a calculator, the cost of retirement index. So you can go online and calculate how much do you need to retire. And so the way this works, if you're age 60 today, you go online and you type in, and what you'll see is that if you want $1 per year in retirement, that's going to cost you today $17.60. So for every dollar that you want, you got to have $17.60. So let's flip that around and put it into another perspective, which is, how much do I need to have saved today at age 60 if I want to have $56,000 per year to spend? And $56,000 isn't an outrageous amount. I need to have $1 million of savings accumulated today. And going back to some of the statistics we saw, only 2/3 of the population who are getting ready for retirement have anything saved. And the average savings is less than $25,000. And then only 4% have at least $500,000 saved. So I just think it's very interesting to understand what those cost. And savings more, whether it's in a DC plan, a DP plan, or individually, I think are a critical part of the solution, as well as the way that this savings gets invested. So just to put into perspective, for an employee, if there is savings of $1,000 per month, and that savings is earning for 30 years, a return of 3%. At the time you're ready to retire, you'll have $600,000. If the same equation holds true, but you're investing it in riskier assets in a way that you can afford to take this risk, you're generating a 6% return. Now at retirement, you have $1 million. So the difference to equalize those two, how much extra do you have to save if your return is only 3%, so you're taking little risk compared to if you can take some more risk? You'd have to save an extra $700 per month. So I think investing well is a really important part of the solution. And the US personal savings rate is about 4.2%. And just put that in the perspective of the average European country savings rate at 7.8%, says there's lots of room just reinforcing savings across all of the stools without a bias of whatever vehicle it goes into being an important thing that we need to think through. So I'll just leave that as my intro.
Okay. I'll try to pick up from there. First of all, I'm Steve Kreisberg with AFSCME, and our union comes at this from a variety of angles. First of all, as representatives of public workers, we're fortunate that about 85 to 90% of our members have good defined benefit pension benefits. Some of our members outside of New York State, probably about 20%, don't have Social Security coverage, so it becomes essential that we have these DB plans. But we also know what's going on in the world. I think James Parrott had some slides that shows the declining proportion of the workforce that is now in pension plans. We all know that. We've seen the numbers before. But we haven't seen before is what we've seen over the last 10 years, which is an incredible amount of political backlash against our membership and their defined benefit pensions. The wealthiest among us would have you believe that it's the pension of a librarian that's caused the recession. How that shakes out and how people ultimately come to understand that to be the case is beyond us. But our members do feel this every day. And a part of the angle as well is that our members come out, in addition to our activist nature at AFSCME, is that we realize we can't be the only workforce left in America with a defined benefit pension. This is a system that has worked well. I think we've heard all three of our introductory speakers, both the Comptroller, Mario, and Vinny, all talk about the rich history of defined benefit pensions, how important it was for families. And the three-legged stool, which was referenced both by James Parrott and by the Comptroller, are very important. So I think when we look at declining retirement security, we can't help but tie this to the rise of individual retirement accounts and the rise of this notion that a 401k system and an IRA system are going to be sufficient retirement vehicles for us. That actually arose around 1980. And you could put it on a graph, you could chart it on a graph, and that began the decline of defined benefit pensions. Now, I don't think all of these things are interrelated, but there is some relationship in there. Rising income inequality started about the same time. Decline of unionization started at about the same time. Now, we all know that there was a seminal event in November of 1980. With the election of Ronald Reagan, which brought about a lot of this as well. Whether that was the single causal factor, again, doesn't make a lot of sense today to speculate about that or to theorize about that. But what we do know is that we've been on the wrong path for 30 years, both in terms of how we deal with income and how we deal with retirement. So when we look at the problems of retirement security, we actually indict the individual savings account approach as part of this. Now, that doesn't mean that individual savings cannot be part of the solution. Our affiliate in Connecticut did great work, we think, over this year in the spring and passed in Connecticut a study bill to study a state-managed individual retirement system, which would have pooled professionally managed assets, which we think is a great improvement. So, we think that these efforts in the states are worthwhile, and I think it's great that people are spending political capital on it, and I think it's even better that we're achieving something. But we, at the national level, as well as a lot of our state affiliates, are very, very leery of this approach because we think we can't fix the problem by doing more of what's created the problem. And I think when Anne Marie gave her example, She talked about somebody setting aside $1,000 a month in savings. That ain't our membership, right? It's not the rising workforce that James talked about, right? Those middle class jobs are vanishing. It's a relatively higher income group that could save $12,000 a year. And I think so these kinds of approaches that we do individual savings, if we're talking about default investment rates of 3 or 4 or even 5%, are likely to be insufficient. They're not going to get us where we need to go. And I think it's important as we study the problem to think about solutions at the same time. And I think we probably need to broaden our horizons a little bit. And so I know that, you know, I'm not the panel that talks about solutions, but I do think it's important when we study the problem to think about the fact that if we can't expand Social Security federally because of the political barriers, we need to be thinking about alternatives. And our union takes some amount of optimism from what our neighbors in the north have just done in Ontario, right? And the Liberals were supposed to lose that election. I know most of us don't follow Canadian politics. I really don't either. You know, it's hard enough to keep track of what's going on here, and it's too depressing to think about what happens here. But in Ontario, the Liberals, who had a huge, huge political problem because of various scandals within their own administration, got reelected anyway. And a big piece of their platform was a provincial retirement system that was modeled basically after a Social Security defined benefit pension system. And what it would produce for about a 4% payroll tax is about $7,500 in annual benefit. So if you think about that and you think about the numbers, where the average Social Security benefit now is about $15,000, $16,000 a year, we can increase people's Social Security benefit by 50% with a program like that. And I think we need to be broader as we study the problem, looking at what's really caused a lot of this insecurity. Because even if we have these savings approaches, we know that there's leakage. Leakage meaning that people wind up spending that money the first time somebody gets substantially sick, when you have the opportunity to send one of your children or your grandchildren to college, and you're a lower income worker, you're earning $35,000 a year, you've saved up maybe $30,000, $40,000, which seems like a lot to you. And now you have a chance to send the next generation onto school to have better opportunities than you had, you're going to do that. That's more important to you than your retirement, because that retirement is out there. And I think we have to understand where these individual savings systems take us and where they have taken us, because the leakage has been a significant problem, and it disproportionately affects lower wage workers. It disproportionately affects single parent households. It disproportionately affects households that are headed by people of color. And I think when we look at these issues, we can't escape the fact that we're creating insecurity by the way we've chosen our retirement system to be over the last three decades. So I'll just conclude on this and turn it over to Dorian to talk some more about these issues. But we talk about the three-legged stool. We have the three-legged stool today, and we're going to have in the future. It's going to be Social Security, small individual savings, and part-time employment. And that's what the statistics show. I think James showed it up there. That's the growing workforce. And what that does is it crowds out opportunities, and it depresses wages. And I think it also undermines the ability to unionize, as we have more part-time employment and more people with casual acquaintance to the workforce. So I think all of those trends are reinforced by an individual savings account approach towards retirement. And they have disastrous consequences for workers overall. So I'll turn it over to you.
Great, thank you. So good morning, everyone. I want to thank Professor Gallarducci for inviting me and the Swartz Center, as well as President Alvarez. It's great to see Comptroller DiNapoli here. I'm following him around these days, but I prefer to speak before he does than after. So I have five problems I want to highlight. They're not exhaustive, but if I were to summarize them, it would be a 30-year, 40-year attack on worker power combined with long-term historical trends of racial inequality. And so I want to raise 5 points, many of which Dr. Parrott already raised and are my co-panelists here. So the first is the loss of wealth in the Great Recession. And I want to focus here on the racial wealth gap in particular as a result of the Great Recession and the collapse of the housing market. And it's worth pointing out there is a report recently released in April by the Center for Global Policy Solutions. One of the co-authors of that report, by the way, is Professor Derek Hamilton here at the New School. which found that the average black household owns 6 cents and the average Latino household owns 7 cents for every dollar of wealth held by the average white family. So really stark disparities. Wealth in communities of color is more concentrated in homes and home equity relative to their white counterparts, although I want to focus on home equity overall because it's so important to talk about home equity in terms of retirement security or insecurity. For whites, home equity is 50% of their overall net worth. For Latinos, homes are 67%, Asians 72%, and for blacks, 92% of personal net worth is in their homes. It's in home equity. Now, of course, leading up to the Great Recession, and we know this story very well, practices of predatory lending by banks targeted communities of color with subprime loans, even when they qualified for prime loans. This led to higher levels of foreclosure and loss of wealth. But in addition to home equity, there's also a liquid asset ratio gap. And according to that same report I cited earlier, and by that I mean families don't have cash or assets readily available for basic living expenses for up to 3 months. So the liquid wealth of whites is over 100 times that of African Americans and 65 times that of Latinos. In 2011, the median liquid wealth for African Americans was $200, Latinos $340, compared to $19,500 for Asians and $23,000 for whites. Over a third of all African Americans have no financial assets at all, as well as a third of Latinos, compared to only 13% of whites. And then you combine all of this, and this, I'm still on problem one, by the way. I'm Debbie Downer this morning, sorry. But this is the problems panel, not the solutions panel. And you combine all this, this is still in terms of the Great Recession, with continued high levels of unemployment, particularly in black communities, where, as I think Dr. Parrott or one of the earlier speakers mentioned, we're still at recession levels of unemployment. But remember, for many black communities, unemployment reached depression-era levels during the height of the Great Recession. So that's problem number one. Problem number two, I just want to make the case for the historical roots of the racial wealth gap and to have us remember that there were racial exclusions in our most revered New Deal social policies, including Social Security. They weren't explicit, but they were de facto. So 65% of all African Americans initially were excluded from Social Security because of two occupational exclusions. Agricultural workers and domestic workers were excluded. This was the compromise with Southern Democrats at the time to get that legislation passed. Thankfully, those exclusions are gone. But you combine those racial exclusions in Social Security, we can add the GI Bill to this, with racial residential segregation and the long history of racially discriminatory housing policy, and that's a second big historical problem that compounds the overall retirement and security crisis, especially for communities of color. I'm going to end this second point by saying, if you want a great read that covers all this ground, read Ta-Nehisi Coates' article in the Atlantic Monthly, The Case for Reparations. By the way, he was on the Colbert Report last night, so you can watch that clip if you want the even shorter version. Okay, problem number three, changes in the nature of the economy and the structure of work. As Dr. Perry pointed out, in New York City, New York State, and across the country, we've seen a loss of mid-wage union jobs and particularly manufacturing jobs, not just in the Great Recession, but over the last 30 years, the rise of low-wage service sector non-union jobs. You combine that with what we call misclassification and the crisis of misclassification, so not calling workers employees, but calling them independent contractors, and therefore not needing or having any responsibility to provide certain benefits or workplace protections. You combine that with wage theft, the literal theft of wages from workers, which is a growing epidemic. The number that comes to mind most immediately is, I think, in 2009 or 2010, the Department of Labor collected about $185 billion in wage theft from employers, which is just the tip of the iceberg of the problem. Combine that with the great risk shift that we've been talking about already, so shifting the risk and cost of retirement security from employers to individual workers, and there are racial disparities here. So some more statistics, because I know we all like numbers this early in the morning. According to the Economic Policy Institute, In 1990, blacks were just as likely as whites to have pensions, roughly 48% to 47%. By 2010, only 43% of blacks, 27% of Hispanics, compared to 50% of whites, were in an employer-based retirement plan. And then you combine all that with the rise in involuntary part-time work, as Dr. Parrott mentioned. This is all part of the broader changing nature of work and structure of work, and the changing practices of employers to shift risk onto individual workers. And it's also a result, or one of the causes here, I would argue, is the decline of worker power. That leads to my fourth point here. The fourth problem is the collapse of the collective bargaining system in America. If we look at the private sector first, and then I'll come to the public sector. In the private sector, and again, this is really important for workers of color, blacks are most likely to be union members over every other racial group, although the rates of unionization are way too low for all in the private sector. But why this matters is that 67% of workers in the private sector have a pension. So 67% in private sector among unionized workers versus 13% of non-union workers have an employer-provided pension. In the public sector, the coverage is 78% nationally of workers who have a retirement security or a pension. And remember, one out of three public employees is still a member of a union. Nationally is much higher here in New York City. This is a really important point. The public sector has been, in the 20th century and well into the 21st century, the most important form of employment for African Americans. The most important. We tend to think and tell, we've told a narrative that how important manufacturing was to African American workers. It's really public employment from the post office in the early 20th century to, in my case, three of my four grandparents were janitors, but were public employees in Chicago. My mother was a teacher. Luckily, she still has a pension, but it's under attack. So the public sector is really, really, really important for African American workers. So I just want to make sure I make that point. But obviously, we live, especially since 2011, and Governor Scott Walker of Wisconsin, who initiated this, we live in a climate where there's an attack on public employee unions and an attack on public employee pensions. So that's the fourth point, is just the broad collapse of the collective bargaining system, especially in the private sector. Last but not least, I want to bring up an issue that, or a problem that I think is a contributor here that we don't talk about, but I think it's important to talk about because in July 2nd will be the 50th anniversary of the 1964 Civil Rights Act. And one of the goals of the 64 Civil Rights Act was to end racial discrimination in employment. 50 years later, there is still deep occupational segregation by race and gender. It's deep and endemic. We made some progress from roughly 1964 to 1980. That progress essentially stopped in 1980 and has been flat. White women, in particular, benefited the most from Title VII of the 64 Civil Rights Act in terms of desegregation of the workplace, but not fully. If we had really reached the promised land, we wouldn't even be talking. Something called a gender pay gap or a racial pay gap wouldn't exist. And those pay gaps are deeply linked to occupational segregation. And we know, to talk about 1980, the Supreme Court in particular has chipped away at every strength of Title VII of that 64 Civil Rights Act to try to combat occupational segregation and discrimination. It's a very weak tool. And as long as we have persistent racial and gender gaps, that is indeed another barrier to building wealth and retirement security, not only for women, people of color, women of color, but for all Americans. So those are my five problems I wanted to lay out and let others figure out what the solutions are.
To actually make the point that all speakers, most of the speakers today, pointed out is that the decline in coverage in any kind of plan, whether it be a defined benefit plan or a 401k plan, some people call them retirement plans, they certainly aren't the way they structured their savings plans and mostly temporary savings plans, was mentioned before, but coverage in any type of plan at work has been falling by 8 percentage points in this country since 2000. That means that it's a secular decline, not just because of the financial crisis. But take a look at this map. This map is color-coded to say, to show you that there's a lot of variation by state. Some of the states are darker, others are light. Now think of what you just learned. You learned about the racial wealth gap. Put in your mind's eye where African Americans who aren't unionized live. Very light color, very low participation rates. Take a look at the dark bits. Very highly unionized areas. So we just at SEPA, we're very proud of this paper. They got published. You're not an academic, you don't know how hard it is to get published in the top journals, but we just got accepted there. Thanks very much to a small crowd. Thank you. The Cornell Labor Journal accepted a paper that probably is the first one they've published in 15 years that has the word bargaining power in it. Mm. We discovered that the variation here and the decline in variation is caused by the lack of bargaining power of workers. Mm-hmm. The high unemployment rates and the decline in unionization is one of the most important variables explaining this variation. And what's worse, you all, is that even large firms aren't sponsoring pension plans for their own workers. It's very disturbing for institutional investors like BlackRock, State Street Bank, Goldman, J.P. Morgan's, our partners in managing institutional money for the state and for the Board of Ed and all your representatives here of pension plans. These are institutional investors who pool assets, manage them well, and return a rate of return that's social, that's in an insurance basis and is paid out in an efficient way. So here is my question to the panel. We've heard a lot about the reason why we have no retirement security in this country is not because of bargaining power, because of flawed human beings. Have you heard that? There's something about the American culture that makes us consume more than other people. There's something about our inability to restrain our demand for current consumption and pleasure and not see our future selves. And that's really the problem, flawed human beings. Well, why is it 20 years ago Americans saved for their retirement? The savings rate, when you included defined benefit contributions, were up to European levels, 8 or 9%. So I want to ask the panel, is it flawed human beings that are the problem, or flawed? It's kind of a loaded question. Or is it something about the pension design, the voluntary, individual-directed, commercial-based pension system that is unique to the United States in being developed and experimented with in the past 30 years. Anne-Marie, that's your cue.
I'd like to come back to the three-legged stool, and we can't ignore that. I think where you see healthy retirement in other countries, they are depending and relying on all three legs of the stool, not just one. So Social Security, we're certainly not going to solve in this room here, but you know, we need to think about certain, really, whether what is its role? Is it the safety net, or is it the primary retirement vehicle? Really considering, though, I know it's controversial, when we see what's happened across a number of states, you know, we've sort of seen the ABCs of thinking about this problem, and I'd add one to that, A, B, C, and I. And this is across the pillars. So we need to have a safety net, a Social Security program. We've got to have employer-sponsored savings programs. And I think importantly, those programs need to help with professional investment options so that people are taking the right amount of risk or the employers on their behalf through that savings section, but also where there's been less emphasis, which is the decumulation phase. So I think it's very important that it just doesn't give you a lump sum at retirement, and then how do you turn that into a lifetime of income after retirement? So thinking not only about how does your employer help you have a vehicle for savings up until retirement, but how do you have the right vehicles and the right mechanisms for for decumulation through that period post-retirement. And then, you know, personal savings, I think, is a valuable third pillar. What we have seen as we've watched what the states have done, and I don't want to get too much into solutions, but I can't help myself, is we have seen movement across at least 10, and I think more states on age, just taking into account this longevity question, and I'm not saying it's right or wrong, but it has happened, and recognizing, I think, the facts that in 1960, there were 5 workers per 1 retiree. You move to 2035, that's projected to be 2 workers per retiree, and today it's 3 workers per retiree. So age has come into the foil of what people have thought about. The benefit level has come into foil as far as really mostly COLAs and double dipping. So not allowing people to be collecting a retirement from one part of, let's say, the state, well, then they're getting a new job in another part. And I think those have been embraced broadly. And then, you know, see contributions. We have seen, you know, if you think about the DB plan, which it provides a guaranteed benefit, and DC, where the responsibility of the benefit gets transferred to the individual, we're seeing more hybrids emerge, where there's a form of risk sharing between the participants and the employees, so that we've seen some states adopt, as investment returns are less than expected, that contribution rates go up both for the participants as well as for the employer. And then, you know, the fourth thing I just mentioned is investments, that the way this money gets invested, the importance of taking risk at a period when bonds throughout the globe are giving no return is really important, but having that risk really thoughtfully managed in a way that people can be comfortable with.
Can we just go down the panel and we'll open it up to the audience?
Yeah, I think in my earlier remarks, I think I answered the question a bit there, that I think it is the system. And I think there's this feature system that Anne-Marie just touched on. I mean, there's, of course, longevity risk, right? That, you know, when we have individual-based accounts, people could outlive their savings or be concerned they will. So we have that, of, you know, but, you know, and we, you know, the idea of annuitizing or what you call decumulation is very important. The investment risk, so we pool investments. I mean, these are things we commonly think about and I think we try to address. And I think some of the more recent policy ideas would address those things. Professionally managed pool investments, not a lot of options for people to invest. Figuring out ways to annuitize lump sums upon retirement in a manner where the insurance companies don't eat up about 25% of the principal in marketing fees, administration, and profit. But we also have timing risk. And so we need to think about ways to have, you know, intergenerational risk sharing, not just risk sharing among the cohort. To deal with some of those issues as well. And these can be managed, and we can deal with these. And I think there are some ideas, kind of centered on cash balance plan approaches. I know I'm getting a little bit technical now, that deal with these. But when we talk about timing risk, it's about when you retired. If you had the good fortune to retire in 2007, you did a lot better than if you had the misfortune of trying to retire on March 31st, 2009. and in case you're not aware of what I'm saying, 40% difference in the price of equities. That was the decline. So, you know, it depends where your investments were, of course. But these are big deals. And you know, and they're almost random events, but, or certainly events outside the control of individuals. But, you know, I like to be a contrarian, so I'm also going to say the fault is in individuals. And I think it's a cultural phenomenon. And I think it was best exemplified by those in the Bush administration, the second Bush. And they talked about the opportunity society and wealth accumulation. And I think there are too many people that have this misguided notion that their retirement savings are really about accumulating wealth. We look at it as old age insurance, right? And as I say when we get into these policy battles about our members' pensions, if you promise our members they won't get old, you can take away their pensions. And we're happy to forfeit our health benefits if you promise we won't get sick. But we're probably going to get sick and we're probably going to get old because getting old beats the alternative. So we're going to need pensions. We're going to need that insurance. We're going to need that steady income as we age out of the workforce, and we should age out of the workforce. But if we buy into this myth that we're going to accumulate all these assets and hand it down to our children. That works well for maybe those in the top 5 or 10% of our income strata. It doesn't work well for everybody else, and it's not going to work well if we continue to see the kind of job growth we've seen, which is concentrated in lower income jobs, where people don't have the opportunities to accumulate any kind of wealth, and they simply don't have the discretionary income to save. So I think we do need to address that issue. We do need to define our terms. What is retirement security? Is retirement security about me handing something down to my children and my grandchildren? Or is it about building a system where everybody's protected in their old age? And then my responsibility to the next generation is to help them be fed, clothed, educated, and taken care of in that manner, and not necessarily handing down wealth. So I think we do need to address that. And I think that's really an individual cultural phenomenon that we don't pay enough attention to.
Just really quickly to answer your question, I think if workers' wages had grown at the same level as worker productivity the last 30 years, we'd have a totally different conversation right now. And it sounds simplistic, but when you have 30 years of wage stagnation, it means you trade wage growth and retirement security for debt. Because as the cost of living increases but wages don't increase, then workers have to rely on debt to consume even basic necessities often. Not to mention, you add consumer debt to, in the case of my profession, student loan debt, especially with household debt. You compound all that, it's a very different conversation if we had had a different economy the last 30 years.
Right, but it also is that, but it's also the rise of the 401k. Open up to the audience. And go back here, and just a statement, because we only have a few minutes.
I'm a retired state employee. I sat in the city's pension fund for 5 years, and I'm very disturbed about something that I see coming that's going to get worse. It's going to affect everybody here, plus our children. When we were told to go to our own investment schemes to grow our wealth over a period of time, it crashed, as we saw in 2007, 2008. Right now, JP Morgan Chase, Citibank, Goldman Sachs, and bankers, and one other bank, they have many, many times the derivative debt as the assets of the bank, many times. What I'm concerned about as we go forward, I can very easily see a tremendous crash coming again, and our 401ks may be a 101k, and we may have even less wealth to talk about. The question is, how do we control the derivative investment in the private sector that's promising us these incredible returns if we go into the private sector with the defined contributions?
Anne-Marie, do you want to?
Well, what is a fact is we are in the largest period of financial reform and regulation change for financial institutions that we've been in for almost 100 years. And a lot is going on, and the banks are dramatically delevering relative to what they were pre the crisis.
Can you describe what that is?
That means that there is less debt going on the bank balance sheets in some ways and across individual balance sheets. So debt has come down. I think it is very important that we continue to learn from the past and watch those metrics. But all of those metrics have, factually improved. As has individual debt burden come down post the crisis. Some people would like to see that help to be a fuel in the economy as far as people spending a bit more overall. But I think you have to really watch the facts in that there has been improvement and enormous regulation coming out that hopefully will help to manage that in a different way on a go-forward basis. But I think we have to stay alert to actually watching the facts of what's going on.
Yeah, the only thing I would add is, as a part of this financial services industry and as it affects retirement investments. Defined benefit pensions are not immune to it. We've seen a lot of exposés recently about just exorbitant fees being paid to hedge fund managers and some of the venture capital firms. We wonder, as participants in the fund, whether or not we're getting our money's worth from these, because it's all these very elaborate schemes. We're not sure that we're getting our money's worth. Fortunately, we have our custodian of the New York State plans hasn't fallen prey to those types of things. And thank you for that.
I want to ask a question about strengthening Social Security. So back in 1983, the Boskin Commission changed the method by which the CPI is calculated. The net result, if you look at the consistent calculation of the CPI, it would be double what it is today. And since Social Security payments are keyed to the CPI, instead of it being $15,000, it would be $30,000 a year, more than double. And people like Bill Gross, who heads the Pacific Income Management Company, largest fixed income manager in the world, has stated in writing, it's on his website, that the CPI calculation is near fraudulent. This from the guy who's at the very top of the heap. And the question is, why do the labor people put up with this? Why haven't labor and all these folks here who get pensions objected to this fraudulent calculation of the CPI?
There's many dimensions. The guy in the White House wants to cut it even more.
Exactly.
Whether we like it or not, it's about our political influence. It's our ability to win elections with policymakers. I mean, the trend, unfortunately, not rightly, but has been the wrong way on CPI. When we elect a guy that we thought was going to be the most progressive president in generations, and he's proposing to reduce the CPI for Social Security recipients, it tells us how badly we are on the wrong track politically, especially when it comes to these types of issues. So we would love to see a CPI based on what it actually costs somebody who is age 65 and over to live, because we know there's a disproportionate amount of money spent on healthcare expenditures, and that inflation in the healthcare arena has far outpaced inflation in others. So the CPI elderly index is being played with and talked about, and it's something we would love to see implemented. But right now, we're trying to hold on to what we have, and we're trying to build the core of the Social Security benefit would be our next step, and that would include possible improvements to the CPI. But there's a lot we tolerate because we live in this society, right? And we don't control politics. We wish we did, and that's the best way I could put it.
I really want to say that we, the labor movement and the Democratic Party, probably stop a partial privatization of Social Security. That was the huge fight every day of 2005, and no Democrat wavered, and a lot of it was a grassroots support of labor unions. You all were involved in that fight to stop it. But the fight is a little bit more subtle. With President Obama, that's the person that Steve Greisberg was talking about, did come out last year with this idea that Social Security might be in trouble. The answer is it is not. It is not in trouble. There are very quick fixes to actually shore it up for the next 75 years and to expand the benefit. And one of the ways to cut benefits was this talk that the CPI had to be readjusted. So that's a fight I think we can take a victory lap around, that we really helped preserve Social Security. And for the first time, I testified in the U.S. Senate Finance Committee 2 weeks ago. For the first time in 35 years, the U.S. Senate is seriously talking about expanding Social Security. It was a dull hearing, but it was a momentous event. And so watch for that and fight to expand Social Security. I have time for just one more question. I'll take it from a woman. And there you are. Very quickly.
I just have a question related to, barring we get everything we want on this, it's still not going to help in terms of purchasing power because of how rich and wealthy, like, the super, super top folks are. How do we change the narrative around not just improving retirement security for everyday folks, but, like,
doing some redistribution on the folks at the top who are still going to be able to buy up all the housing and all the health care and everything else.
Dorian, would you like to?
Now you got the solution, not the problem.
That's Kate Spaulding, who's the troublemaker, who asked that question. I mean, you know, that was part of what I was getting at earlier with the fact we traded redistribution with debt in the last 30 years. Is one way to think about it. I think that's a political answer, Kate, and it goes to what we were just saying in terms of the strength of the labor movement, in particular as the key institution shaping not only the Democratic Party, but progressive politics more broadly to reshape our politics at the local, state, and national level. So that's a, you know, we don't have enough time here to talk about how to fix redistribution and the rise of the top 1%, but it is, I think, the solution here is a strong labor movement and the reclamation of worker power at the workplace, which then extends into the political sphere and into communities. That's a very short answer.
No, made a move. I have time for one more question.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Most of us, my generation, have gone through three serious financial crises. First of the Reagan, the savings and loan. Everybody remember that? Mm-hmm. Then we had the dot-com, the next nightmare. Now we had the housing market. Mike, Dorian, you alluded to it. How do you build the next model that somewhat insulate us from these crazy schemes? Because clearly there is the redistribution of debt and wealth. And clearly we need to build some kind of model that can insulate the working mass. So now, then, since BlackRock is here, and that's what we would like to think about. How do we build that model? Because that's where I think we want to go. Because in my lifetime, I've gone too big.
Yeah. I'll just say that two very important concepts come to mind as far as that goes, which is each financial crisis was followed by a recovery. And the scary part of the financial crisis is if you have to make that decision of conversion of your assets or determining what your retirement is at a single point in time. So it is very important that people can invest in a way that keeps them invested at times when asset prices are low or really rebalancing up their risk at those periods so they can grow back out of it. And that the determine of the balance gets, you know, there's ability to smooth what you have or elongate your investment horizons to live through moments of crises, which are generally single points in time. Now, this has been an elongated recovery, but indeed, asset classes have gone through enormous recovery over this time. What happens to the individual if they're only making individual decisions is they de-risk at the exact wrong moment. Mm-hmm. And so they do suffer the decline, but they don't benefit from the recovery.
That's great.
So yeah. I think the one very important thing is to help people to not be subject to single points in time of determination of what their wealth is, and also help them to take risk at the times when the most benefit from that recovery.
And that's exactly what your defined benefit plans do. I'd like to welcome Comptroller Stringer, who just walked in and joined Tom DiNapoli. Again, I really want to thank our elected officials for being here. You are public servants and you are representatives. Thank you very much. Let's take a short break and then come back and hear from Comptroller Stringer. Thank you.
And thank you, panel.
Thank you, sir. Steve, very nice to meet you.
I learned a lot. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I learned a lot.
Thank you.
All right, you all, this is your 2-minute warning.
please start migrating back to your seats? Hello, everyone. I would like to invite you to... I'm going to wait a little bit. Sorry. Okay. I'd like you to invite you to take your seats. I again appreciate you being here this morning. It is my pleasure to introduce Janella Hines. She is the Secretary Treasurer of the New York's Central Labor Council. Oh, great style. and the Vice President of Academic High Schools in New York City. And she will give us our pleasure in introducing our next elected official, Scott Stringer. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Now, you all may not know, I am a high school social studies teacher, so all of this movement makes me very, very uncomfortable. I'm gonna ask you all to please be seated so that we can welcome our next speaker to the podium. Everyone with me? So far, we've discussed the crisis in retirement security. We've talked about the problems, and we are going to be thinking about solutions. And all of this information is sobering, and I am looking forward to continuing the conversation on how we improve conditions, specifically for those of us here in New York City. And so our next speaker is our New York City's 22nd Comptroller, Scott Stringer. From his days representing Manhattan's 67th Assembly District to representing Manhattan as borough president, Comptroller Stringer has been a friend of working men and women. He stood with us on picket lines. He has spoken at our rallies. And just yesterday, he called for the city's minimum wage to be increased to $13.13. He also stood with city council colleagues to announce legislation that would guarantee workers the right to ask for schedule adjustments to care for family members without the fear of retaliation from their employers. Comptroller Stringer has consistently stood with the labor movement to fight for the rights of working people
and we are pleased that he has joined us this morning. So join me in welcoming our friend, New York City Comptroller Scott Stringer.
Well, thank you for that very nice introduction, and I was very honored to go to City Hall steps and talk about raising the minimum wage, and I was really excited to bring my 2.5-year-old son, Max, and my 1-year-old son, Miles, and for those of you in AARP who are represented today, you know, I'm an ARB dad, so so we need some flex time as well. But today I want to start out by thanking Vinny Alvarez of the New York City Central Labor Council, AFL-CIO. Vinny has been such a stalwart for working people, and this conference is very much his vision, and I want to give him a big round of applause. And I also want to recognize somebody who I've served with, and now both in the Assembly and now in this role as Comptroller, with somebody who I think is just elevating what the possibilities and potentials are for the Office of Comptroller, and that's the soon-to-be re-elected Tom DiNapoli. And please let me acknowledge Professor Teresa Ghilarducci of the New School for inviting me to speak today. I really appreciate it. We can give her a round of applause, too, because she's pretty terrific. And of course, the Schwartz Center for Economic Policy Analysis here at the New School for hosting this critically important conference. Now, I've been city controller for 6 months, and I'm honored by the chance to implement my vision for what this office can and must achieve. Above all, the controller has to be the primary watchdog of the city's fiscal health and an advocate for economic prosperity. And one of this office's most crucial duties is to be a careful steward of New York City's 5 pension funds, valued at nearly $150 billion in assets and managed by some of the finest institutional investors in the country. These funds safeguard retirement security for over 700,000 active and retired civil servants, including police, firefighters, teachers, nurses. They are the backbone of New York's middle class. Our retired workers rely upon their pensions, along with Social Security and personal savings, the three-legged stool of retirement planning, to live in dignity after a lifetime of work. But in recent years, we've all witnessed attacks on civilian public pensions. These allegations are not only inaccurate, they're insulting to the people who have worked hard all their lives. Public pensions aren't lavish. The average person for recent city retirees, the average pension for recent retirees is just over $35,000. And pensions aren't a gift, they're earned. They're part of the employee's compensation package. Pensions are a powerful tool for attracting higher skilled individuals to work in municipal government, where compensation is lower than the private sector. The sad fact is that our problem is not that too many people have pensions or that they're too generous. The problem is too many people have nothing at all besides Social Security. And as we've heard today, 59% of New Yorkers lack access to a retirement plan at their place of employment. The solution is to strengthen the retirement safety net for everyone. We need to grow this pie, not shrink it. So the task before us is clear. We need to create more retirement saving options and provide all New Yorkers with more opportunities to plan for their future. Above all, we need to start a conversation about how our retirement security challenge in New York and what it will take to address this crushing need. Now, I'm not saying it's going to be easy. I think we all know that. But we're not starting from scratch. We've already seen a number of creative ideas emerging from government, unions, academia, and trade groups. That includes the National Conference of Public Employees Retirement Systems under the leadership of Executive Director Hank Kim and our very own Mel Aronson, now Executive Board President of NYPERS. Give Mel a round of applause. By the end of 2014, low and middle income workers without access to workplace retirement plan will be able to open up a no-fee Roth IRA account with as little as $25 and save up to $15,000 with no risk or losing the principal. Meanwhile, retirement security legislation has been introduced in at least 15 states. California was the first state to pass comprehensive legislation. They have just released the first RFP to study the legal issues associated with its Secure Choice program. The state of Massachusetts passed legislation in 2012 to allow non-for-profit organizations with fewer than 20 employees to join an existing plan for state workers, which is awaiting approval by the feds. But here's the bottom line. No one has solved the puzzle yet, in part because of the complex legal landscape. Retirement plans are heavily regulated, as they should be, and any solution will have to be consistent with federal law. But it's precisely because it's so hard and the stakes are so high that we must start to build a real consensus. As we explore the potential of publicly sponsored retirement solutions for the private sector, let me identify some fundamental principles that must anchor us. First, additional retirement savings accounts must supplement, not supplant, the role of Social Security. Second, taxpayers must be protected from any risks associated with investment-related losses. And third, public sector retirement funds must be safeguarded. Whatever approaches emerge, there are design features that should be part of any retirement savings plan. They must include professional investment management. Few of us have the knowledge or time to make the best decisions about investing our money. I usually turn to Tom DiNapoli for that advice. Investing requires the skills of professionals governed by a strict set of ethical practices. Let me say that, a strict set of ethical practices. We also have to look at lower fees. Individual retirement holders pay some of the highest fees out there, and this substantially decreases returns over an investor's lifetime. We should talk about automatic enrollment. We should make enrollment in a retirement saving plan automatic with an opt-out feature. Studies have shown that this greatly increases participation rates, especially among groups most vulnerable to retirement insecurity, such as women and low-income workers. Many young people today do not believe that even if they're in a public pension plan, that they're actually going to see the money, so they don't opt in. They choose to spend the extra money on the weekend. In my office, I demand as much as I can that they think about the future, and it's hard to think about it when you're in your 20s. I've learned that, like many of you here. So we've got to get a real opt-in plan that works for our young people as well. Now, I know a lot of questions remain, and I challenge our panelists today to confront them. Are there other models that offer pension-like features in an individual account setting? We should talk about that. How would the requirements of ERISA mesh with a publicly sponsored private sector retirement? We should discuss that as well. If public pension funds invest for private sector employees, what changes in laws and regulations are needed? And lastly, how do we make savings for retirement feasible for lower-income New Yorkers, many of whom struggle to pay the rent and put food on the table? Now, my office is committed to exploring options that would expand retirement security, and today we're turning that commitment into a plan of action. I'm pleased to announce this morning that my office will be creating an advisory panel this fall to study options that create greater retirement security for all New Yorkers. This group will be led by Scott Evans, our newly appointed Chief Investment Officer for the New York City Pension Funds. Scott comes to us with decades of knowledge in the finance field, including 27 years at TIAA CREF, the nation's largest retirement provider. He's been an industry leader in finding innovative and low-cost ways to invest and fund retirements for working people. We're entering a period where baby boomers will be retiring in large numbers and living longer. We need to try to maximize their financial independence and lower their need to rely on city-funded services. This will not only help preserve our fiscal health, we'll also promote our economic well-being by giving seniors the financial resources to partake in all that our great city has to offer. Again, I just want to be clear. My primary obligation will always be to protect taxpayers and uphold the interests of our pension beneficiaries. Being a fiduciary of a $150 billion pension fund is serious business. Tom DiNapoli knows this all too well. But this conference marks a historic first step towards a destination we should all want to reach, a city where everyone has a chance to create their own safety nets, a city where people enter retirement with a sense of security through hard work and wise investing. We can and we must solve this problem, folks. It's been an honor to collaborate with Vinny and all of you in this effort. I'm very proud to be here. Our office wants very much to work with you, and I want to thank you for giving me this opportunity. And with that said, it's now my responsibility and great honor to return this microphone to our moderator, Teresa Ghilarducci, and I look forward to hearing the speakers today. Thank you very, very much. Thank you.
Hey, hey, our first action, first time I've heard of are the advisory council. Thank you very much, and we'll be working with the state. Talk about how to coordinate. That's terrific. It is my pleasure to now move to the solutions part of our day, and I will introduce our panel and my three friends. First of all is Damon Silvers, who is the counsel for the AFL-CIO. He also works for us in the state. Is Damon not here yet? Right, I had that rustling. Damon's very busy because he is the general counselor for the national AFL-CIO, and he also works for us in New York City. He serves pro bono for the Attorney General in areas related to the worker protection of our Attorney General. Our other panelist is my friend and colleague, John Adler. His title is Private Equity Director of the SEIU Capital Stewardship Program, but we know him here at SEPA as coordinating that union's efforts to establish secure choice plans across the country, and also is a convener of a coalition of academics, of labor unions, and of other advocacy groups that really raises up the problem of retirement insecurity and seeks a solution. Steve Greisberg is another aspect to it. They merge together like a puzzle. To just go back to what I first said, that we're dedicated all here, that everyone deserves retirement security after a lifetime of dignified work. That's John Adler. And last panelist is someone I just met. She's a professor and a labor organizer. What better is there? Barbara Bowen, where are you? Who is a professor at CUNY and the president of her union. So thanks very much. Please join us.
So Damon cedes his time to you,
John. Okay. So I have a couple of slides.
Oh. Thanks a lot.
Okay, great. Thank you very much, Teresa.
Does everyone know Alex? Just raise your hand. Hi. Alex, please. Yeah, we all know Alex.
You get when you're a former student.
Yeah, that's right. He got an A in my class.
That's not true.
The truth comes out.
Retroactive grade change.
There's a market for that.
Okay. Okay, thank you very much. My name's John Adler. I work for SEIU. My title is actually not private equity director. I really work on retirement security. That's what I do. I'd like to thank Professor Ghilarducci and Vinny for organizing this conference, and it's a pleasure to be here. So this is the solutions panel, and this is the my eyes glaze over section where I get into all the technical stuff. I've got a very complicated slide up there, which I'm going to try to walk through to talk about what the different elements of these state-based solutions that people are considering look like, and then sort of what's been done in different states. Oh, thank you so much. It's just two slides, so. But I'm going to start with this one. So what I'm trying to do is go through Barbara, you can look on at mine if you want. Yeah. Yeah, no problem. Different areas that the plans are seeking to address. So the first is participation, right? So the fundamental question here is we're trying to, as we've all talked about, address those workers who do not have a retirement plan through work now. And that is roughly half the workforce in the country, give or take. And it varies a little bit by state. And so, the first question is, do you make the plan voluntary? Do you make it mandatory? Or do you make it auto-enrollment with opt-out? Okay? So under our current retirement system, you cannot have a mandatory retirement plan, right? The only mandatory plan that we have is Social Security, which is technically a social welfare program, a universal social welfare program. It's not a retirement plan per se. And so of these different options that are up here, the only one that would be universal is the supplemental state Social Security plan, which is the second to last column on the slide. And Steve Kreisberg alluded to this earlier, I think. A supplemental state Social Security plan is similar to what Ontario is proposing in Canada, which is that a state would create its own miniature version of Social Security, which would be funded by a payroll tax like the federal Social Security program is, and could provide a substantial supplement to Social Security. The difference between the federal program and the state program is that the federal program is not invested in a diversified portfolio. It's just, as we know, invested in treasuries, whereas the proposal for a state program would be to invest it by the state or by the city in a diversified portfolio like a public pension fund to essentially use investment returns to fund a large portion of the benefit. The other plans are typically voluntary plans, and one sort of variant on the voluntary plan is auto-enrollment with opt-out, right? So in that situation, if you work for an employer that doesn't offer a retirement plan, that employer would enroll all of its employees in the state plan, but the employees would have the ability to opt out if they chose to. And the reality in the defined contribution space is that these auto-enrollment plans have been shown that roughly 80 to 90% of participants stay in the plans. And so it's a much preferable way to get people into the plans than just have a voluntary plan. So if you look at these options that are up here, and I'm gonna run through them now so you sort of see, I guess there are seven. So the first one, the left column, is the National Conference of Public Employee Retirement Systems, Secure Choice, and quotes heavy. And I want to acknowledge Mel Aronson, who is the head of NCPERS, really taking a lot of intellectual leadership in terms of creating these plans. And the NCPERS, both NCPERS plans are what's known as cash balance plans. We talked about earlier, they're a variant on a traditional defined benefit plan. They would be voluntary participation for employers and for employees. Then the next set of three plans are different states. Variations on these plans, the nomenclature is very confusing because everybody likes the term secure choice. So you have four different versions of secure choice up here. So the third one in the third column is California secure choice, and that, along with the Illinois secure choice plan and the Washington State START plan, are all based on individual retirement accounts. And then, as I discussed before, the supplemental state Social Security plan is a defined benefit plan. The last one, a multiple employer plan, let me just spend a minute describing that. First of all, a multiple employer plan, just to make the nomenclature more confusing, is not to be confused with a multi-employer plan, right? A multi-employer plan is a collectively bargained Taft-Hartley plan where a union and a set of employers agree to the terms of the plan. A multiple employer plan is where multiple employers come together to offer a single pension plan to their employees. Multiple employer plans are permitted under ERISA if the employers have a pre-existing relationship. However, the Department of Labor has taken the position that multiple employer plans are not permitted among unrelated employers. And so really the proposal for a multiple employer plan would require either Department of Labor to change its regulatory guidance to permit a state or a city to sponsor a multiple employer plan among unrelated employers, or that could be accomplished through federal legislation. And there actually are two bills in Congress right now, neither of which I think has any chance of passage, since virtually nothing has any chance of passage in Congress right now, that would allow these multiple employer plans among unrelated employers. Okay, so then I want to move down the chart so I don't, too quickly try your patience with all this technical stuff. The next issue under participation is the issue of portability, right? Whether you can take the plan from employer to employer. The secure choice plans have limited portability. That is, they're portable among those employers that choose to participate in the NCPERS secure choice plans. The two state secure choice plans would be completely portable within the state so that, you know, if you changed employer within the state, you could keep your money in the plan. For Washington State, the Washington State plan, which is just totally voluntary, right? It's a voluntary plan. There's no auto enrollment or anything like that. It would just be limited to those participants that choose to participate. Hi, Damon. Good. The supplemental state Social Security plan would be completely portable among employers in the state because it would be universal among employers in the state. And then the multiple employer plan, again, would be limited to those employers that participate in that multiple employer plan. Okay, I've really already alluded to the issue of plan design, whether these plans are DB, defined benefit plans, or defined contribution plans. Let me just point out that the multiple employer plan, the last column, could be either defined benefit or defined contribution. Under ERISA, either type is permitted. And so let me just make sure that various people have referred to ERISA. Let me just make sure that we know what we're talking about with ERISA. ERISA is the 1974 Employee Retirement Income Security Act, right? Did I get that right, Damon? And it is the really the landmark federal legislation that governs pension plans in the private sector, okay? It does not apply to public pension plans. Public pension plans are not subject to ERISA. All private pension plans are subject to ERISA, and that includes 401ks and those type of plans, as well as defined benefit plans. However, individual retirement accounts, IRAs, are not subject to ERISA. They have a safe harbor from ERISA. So that is why many of the state plans have chosen the IRA as the vehicle for the plan in order to avoid preemption by ERISA. Right, because one of the aspects of ERISA is that it preempts state laws governing private sector pensions. So states are really not permitted to pass legislation that affects private sector pensions as preempted by ERISA. So this is, this is all, I'm not a lawyer, let me just say right up front. This stuff is what the lawyers explained to me, and hopefully I'm getting it more or less right.
You have your doubts, right?
I do have my doubts, yes. So, and I'm sure Damon will correct me things I get wrong. Okay. So then moving on to the issue of contributions. A big issue with ERISA is whether there are employer contributions permitted or not, because in general, if a plan accepts employer contributions, it becomes an ERISA plan. Individual retirement accounts do not accept employer contributions for the most part. And therefore, that's, again, it goes with them not being subject to ERISA. And one of the reasons that states have looked at IRAs is one of the ways to do a solution that doesn't get entangled with ERISA. The NCPERS plans do accept employer contributions because the Secure Choice Heavy plan would be an ERISA plan. The Secure Choice Light plan is not an ERISA plan, and the way it gets around ERISA is that it proposes using a state-chartered bank to be the provider of the plan. Banks have an exemption from ERISA. So this would be a sole purpose bank set up just to administer the retirement plan. However, because it does that, it's not a qualified plan, which is another legal term of art. And that means that it cannot accept tax-favored contributions. So it would be essentially post-tax contributions. However, on the far side, when you get your money out, it's not taxable. Since it was taxed on the way in, it doesn't get taxed on the way out, similar to a Roth IRA or a Roth 401k. So those are the distinctions there in terms of contributions. The IRA-based plans do not accept employer contributions. And then, obviously, the supplemental state Social Security plan, it's not really an employer contribution. It's a payroll tax that would be split between the employer and the employee, much as federal FICA is. And then the multiple employer plan could accept employer or employee contributions as an ERISA plan. So then let's talk about, I've got two other areas to talk about, investment management and payouts. So on investment management, the fundamental issue, I think, well, there's two fundamental issues. One is, are the investments self-directed, as they are in a typical 401k plan or a typical IRA, or are the investments pooled and professionally managed the way they are in a typical defined benefit plan? And so for most of these plans, the idea is to pool the money and professionally manage it. As numerous other speakers have talked about, that's lower cost, greater returns, and the ability to share risk. The exception to that is the Illinois Secure Choice Plan is sort of set up like a almost like a 529 plan, if folks are familiar with those college savings plans, where the state would select a vendor to provide investment options. Could also be thought of as the federal thrift savings plan model, similar to that. The rest of the plans would all be pooled, professionally managed. And then the other fundamental question about investment management that we've also alluded to is who bears the risk? So under the two NCPERS plans, ultimately the employer that participates still bears the risk. The risk would be minimal in those plans because they would be very, very conservatively funded. But if they're in an adverse event, the plan does have the right to go back to the employer for additional contributions. Under the California Secure Choice Plan, the plan would obtain private insurance to provide a guarantee so that the employee would not bear the risk and the state would not bear the risk. They would contract with private insurance to provide the guarantee. Exactly what form that takes is very much up in the air because there could be a lot of different types of insurance that they could procure. There's no guarantee in the Illinois Secure Choice Plan or the Washington State START Plan. Under the supplemental state Social Security plan, ultimately the state would be the bearer of the risk, and so the state would be on the hook to make sure that the benefits are paid for. I mean, you could set it up so that benefits could be variable. That would minimize the risk, but if there were a fixed benefit, the state would be on the hook. And under a multiple employer plan, again, you could sort of do it any way you want in terms of who bears the risk. That, to me, the question of risk, and obviously risk is very much related to return, is a key question for these funds. Do we want to create a plan? Sort of, in some ways, you have this MyIRA that Control Stringer talked about, the new federal plan that the Obama administration is rolling out, which is a no-risk plan that is just going to be invested in treasuries, but of course is going to generate an infinitesimal return as well, and maxes out at $15,000, right? Which not too many people can retire on a $15,000 account. The idea there, of course, is to roll it over into a private Roth IRA once you reach $15,000. But, you know, I would argue that folks that are just starting out their retirement savings really don't need a no-risk or low-risk plan. They need a risk plan that's going to generate attractive returns. Be that as it may. I do think that this question of risk and who bears it and the relation to return is a crucial issue for these plans to determine. Okay, then lastly, we have the issue of payout or decumulation, as Anne-Marie talked about in her presentation. And really the question here is, are we paying out in the form of annuities? Or are we providing lump sums or some combination? And the NCPERS plans provide for annuitization, full annuitization. So folks are going to get guaranteed monthly income for life. The California Secure Choice Plan provides for partial annuitization. You know, so it's not 100% annuitization, nor is it 100% lump sum, but you get part of it in an annuity. You can take off in an annuity if you want, but you don't have to. Under the other state plans, it's totally optional. In a supplemental state Social Security plan, it would be in the form of an annuity, no questions asked, just like Social Security is in the form of an annuity. And again, a multiple employer plan, it would be optional. The question of how the money comes out is also related to this question of leakage, which Steve Kreisberg alluded to in his presentation. You know, leakage is this concept of folks putting money into a retirement savings account, but then taking it out and using it for other purposes. You know, I would say mostly, although this is just anecdotal, for, you know, the necessities that come up of life when you lose your job, where you have a medical emergency or bankruptcy or you're facing foreclosure, whatever, or putting a kid into college, you're going to use your retirement money for that because retirement can wait, right? Again, the great advantage of defined benefit plans is they tend to have very little or no leakage, whereas defined contribution plans lend themselves to leakage for the most part. So, you know, if you go across here, the defined benefit plans have no leakage. The other plans, there's definitely a possibility of leakage. And there's a question, I think, as to whether you could structure one of these state plans that is a retirement savings plan, but that essentially prevents people from taking the money out early to pay for something other than retirement. It's unclear as to legally, under the federal scheme, whether you could do that, whether an IRA, for example, could prevent leakage or not. Not clear. So I just want to make one more point, then I'll cede the microphone, which is that there is one other element here that I think could be very helpful for these state plans. We have talked a lot about the fact that we're really talking about a population of low and middle income workers who don't have a heck of a lot of discretionary income to put aside for savings. There exists something at the federal level called the Federal Savers Credit, which very few people know about because I think very few people can take advantage of it because it's really, really small. It essentially maxes out at $1,000 for an individual, and the maximum income level for an individual is like $27,000 and change. And so, and the reality, it's not refundable either, so that, which means that if you don't pay taxes because you're getting the earned income tax credit, then this thing has no value to you whatsoever. If we could make the federal savers tax credit refundable, a little bit more lucrative, and have higher income limits that it applies to, that, if you combine that with a state plan, could really help low and middle income people start to put something real into these accounts instead of, you know, right now we're really talking about folks not having enough money to save to make a difference for their retirement. And to me, that's something that, you know, yes, it will cost the federal government some money, but compared to the amount of money that the federal government spends on tax expenditures for retirement for upper income earners, it would pale. We could take a very small part of what we spend for folks in the top tax bracket to put, up to $50,000 a year into 401ks and similar savings vehicles, take a little bit of that and increase the tax savers credit for low and middle income workers and really make a difference for their ability to have a better retirement. So I will leave it at that and turn it over to Damon or to Barbara. To Damon.
All right. Well, thank you all, and good morning. Let me apologize for joining my panel a little late. I was those of you who may know Richard Ravitch, it's kind of hard. Sorry, I said those of you who know Richard Ravitch may know it's a little hard to escape it, to escape his company when he wants to talk to you. Let me begin. I'm Damon Silvers. I'm the National Policy Director of the AFL-CIO. Let me begin by, on behalf of President Trump, to express, you know, our gratitude to Vinny Alvarez for the leadership in convening this meeting and for the subject matter of it. It's, I think, very important to note that the subject matter of this meeting is the retirement security of all New Yorkers, not just those who may belong to a union, not just those who may want to belong to a union, not just those who may be eligible to belong to a union, but all New Yorkers. And this is very important in terms of what President Trumka wants the labor movement to stand for nationally. I also want to, on behalf of our national leadership, express our undying gratitude to the elected officials here for all they have done, not just in this particular convening, but for years, as advocates of retirement security for all, not just all New Yorkers, but for all Americans, to Controller DiNapoli, to Controller Stringer, and to the person who's not here, but whose ascension in public life has been so important to the cause of working people, and that's Mayor de Blasio. Now, I've been tasked, I think, after this encyclopedic review of the options and the possibilities in front of us, and I gather, although I was not here, that this follows on a similarly detailed and learned presentation by Steve Kreisberg from AFSCME, that I'm tasked now with trying to kind of comment on this, I think, from the perspective of kind of what the national policy, what the national landscape looks like in terms of retirement security, what lessons can be drawn here in New York City from the national experience of trying to address these issues, and whatever sort of advice we can kind of lay on the table here. Let me begin by saying that, and I think you've heard this already in a New York-specific way, I want to talk about it at a national level. We're in the midst of a slow-motion retirement security crisis. It's different than healthcare, where you could point at at any time in the last 50 years, you could point to huge numbers of Americans who didn't have access to health insurance. This is a situation where we actually had a pretty decent retirement system at one time, and we've systematically taken it apart. Right? We've basically put dynamite in the foundations and pushed a plunger. But because of the way retirement systems work, it takes a long time for that set of really terrible policy choices to evolve to the point where it's really felt on the street and in people's pocketbooks. Let me just sort of put some numbers in front of you that you may have heard already. If you have, I apologize for repeating them, but they're worth taking in, right? Which is in 1983, which was kind of at the very nadir, the very depths of a long bear stock market. Right, so I forget what the actual number of the Dow Jones was in 1983, but it was around 1,000. Right, in 1983, 2/3 of Americans could, based, this is not like an opinion poll, this is a measure of objective retirement security assets done by the Retirement Security Center at Boston College, Alicia Monell, who I think is generally recognized the most reputable analyst in this field. 2/3 of Americans. I'm sorry, Teresa. No offense meant. There can be many reputable analysts. There are some people who feel Teresa agrees with us too much. At least less so. Two-thirds of Americans in 1983 were, as an objective matter, looking forward to retirement in relative financial security. 1/3 were not. 33% had a serious risk of not being able to maintain their standard of living and having real financial problems in retirement. Today, actually, we don't have this number for today, but in 2010, right, and there's a lot of reason to believe that, if anything, this number may have gotten a little worse, right, in 2010, when even after the financial crisis, the Dow Jones was at around 11,000, 12,000, so 12 times the value that it was in 1983, when our GDP had grown, I don't know, it's a multiple. Our GDP is substantially larger than it was in 1983. 55% of Americans approaching retirement were at risk of financial insecurity in retirement. 55%, the majority, right? And this number is likely to continue to rise. Right? This is what we mean when we say we are having a slow-motion retirement security crisis. And if you think about that, those numbers in relationship to the values, to the value of the assets in the American economy, and particularly the value of the capital markets that we have chosen as a policy matter to look to fund retirement with increasing degrees of severity over this period, and you see how much they've risen. You understand this is not a question of the United States being somehow unable to afford retirement security for the majority of its population. It is that we have chosen not to. Right? And the ways we have chosen not to are fundamentally connected to the real kind of underlying crisis in our economy, which is a crisis of wage stagnation. Right? That, again, I'll shift the time frame here a little bit, that for the majority of Americans, right, if you decompose the wages paid to different portions of our society, for the majority of Americans since 1997, real wages have fallen. Right. There's a small portion of Americans for which they've gone up and gone up significantly. That results in an average that makes it look like real wages are rising. But for the majority of our society, for the bottom 90%, real wages are falling. That is the background against which we have cannibalized our retirement system. Right? And it is unavoidably connected with the decline of collective bargaining, and particularly the decline of collective bargaining in the private sector. Right. The numbers in New York City, which I think you've seen already, are very powerful in relation to the difference in terms of retirements, access to retirement plans between workers who have collective bargaining and workers who don't. The same thing is true nationally, and it is profoundly true historically. Right. The access of the typical American to a functioning pension plan is completely the consequence of the strength of collective bargaining in the private sector following World War II. And as a result of intentional policy decisions, the dismantling of collective bargaining, particularly in the private sector, since 1980 is completely tied up with the dismantling of meaningful retirement security for working Americans. It's very hard to imagine how we're going to solve these problems separately from each other. Right? And so that's the backdrop in which this conversation is being held. Now, I've been doing this long enough that I've been saying that we're going to face a slow motion retirement security crisis since the mid 1990s. And when I started saying this, I was saying basically, if you look at the trend lines here, you can see where this is all going to lead. Now I can say we're there. We're there at the place that I was pointing to in the mid to late 1990s, and we're going to get more and more there. But, you know, our polity is not completely disconnected from reality. And so increasingly today, instead of being this kind of lone, wacky voice in a room full of people talking about Dow 35,000 and the wonder of defined contribution plans and how everything is so much better now that we've traded, you know, actual pension plans for savings accounts, now everybody agrees. Now I go to, like, you know, joint management, you know, management labor meetings and things with academics and think tanks. Now everybody agrees we got a big problem, right? And everybody agrees that the DC system is broken, right? That we dismantled the defined benefit plan system, we replaced it with a defined contribution plan system, so we don't have the DB system anymore, and the DC system we built doesn't work. This is now consensus, right? If anybody tells you that the DC system is wonderful and has solved all our problems, they are now that's now an outlier position. But the question is now what to do. What to do. And I'm going to tell you a little bit of a story about federal policy in this area that I think will perhaps inform your thinking about the encyclopedia that John shared with you earlier. So I think it's probably true that this consensus was already kind of arriving in 2008, as President Obama launched, you know, his campaign for the presidency. And although it was obviously not on the front burner the way healthcare was, there was some thought that we ought to do something about this. But there was also a recognition that it would be really hard, that genuine retirement security is expensive, right? That, in particular, and again, this goes back to the history of labor relations in the United States, that as a result of a fundamental deal that got made in the 1940s between largely the industrial unions of the CIO, the major manufacturing employers, and the Truman administration, as a result of that deal, we have a really pretty radically underpowered Social Security system. Right? In terms of income replacement rates compared to other advanced societies, we're kind of at the level of half what the comprehensive retirement security systems of other developed countries provide. Now, I mean, there's some other outliers. We're not the only one that's as cheap as we are. But but we're way down there. And we knew this in the 1940s. We knew that this was a problem. And the leaders of the CIO at that time demanded that Social Security essentially provide roughly twice the benefits it does today. And the employers didn't like that. The employers wanted to have control over the money. And so the employers said, well, we can't do that, but instead, why don't we expand our pensions, which at that time were essentially just for the executive suite. We'll expand our pensions to cover all of you. How's that for a deal? And since the politics of the late 1940s were in some ways not that different from the politics of today in terms of the overall balance of power between progressives and reactionaries and so forth, and in terms of the overall ugliness of the climate, people like Walter Ruther said, okay, you got a deal. We'll do it that way. The result is we have this really underpowered Social Security system, which produces on average about 30% income replacement, whereas other advanced societies produce about 60%. That's why we're having this meeting, fundamentally. Right, was that the deal that Ruther took, which seemed like not a terrible deal at the time, has not worked out so well. Right? In fact, it's kind of collapsed. Right? And the employers have walked away. The employers didn't mention to Ruther that this was a deal with a time limit. Right? And the employers have essentially walked away. So that when Obama shows up and says, let's do something about retirement security, it's really clear really fast that the entire political weight of American business is going to push back around the idea of actual money. Right, of actual employer money into the retirement security system. Because they had successfully, over the last generation, gone from a situation where basically, if you were going to function in the U.S. economy as a large company, you're going to put 8-10% of payroll into a defined benefit pension plan, to a situation where you're going to put nothing. Nothing. Right, where you would have a match, and if your employees decide to put money in, and you put a little bit in to match them and all that. But what that actually turned up on the cash flow statement was essentially nothing. Right, so then there's this issue in federal policy of what do we do, and the Obama administration had a lot of heavy lifts at the time, and their appetite for full-on confrontation with all of American business over trillions of dollars of money, maybe not so great, right? And so they said, well, let's try to look for something that is. That we can get everybody to agree on, that will be a light lift. And what they came up with, and it had been tossed around in think tanks for a while in Washington beforehand, was something called auto IRA. And this was mandatory in the sense that they're basically saying to employers, you've got to provide this. Right? But it was not mandatory for employees. And it did not require any employer money. Right? It's just an account. It said basically to the employers, you must offer your employees the default option of putting money into this account. No employer money, no mandatory employee savings. None of the things that John went through in all these different options around pooled money and annuitization and risk management, all that. Just an account. Now, this sounds, if you think about the fact that the problem is we're missing 10% of payroll, right? This is pretty modest stuff. Right? It's the kind of thing you would think that people of goodwill, both parties, business, labor, could agree upon would be okay. So do we have it today? No. It's no closer actually to being enacted than any of the much more ambitious ideas that are out there in American politics associated with the first year of the Obama administration. And not only is it kind of nowhere in being enacted, but for those of you who are in this room who represent other people, right, if you convened a meeting of your membership and asked them, what is the Obama auto IRA? I don't know. Some people might think it had something to do with the Irish Republican Army. So what does this tell us? What does it mean that this totally almost insignificant, Cass Sunstein-esque nudge is totally dead? I think it means a couple things, and these are important lessons, I think, for policymakers here in New York City. I think it means, first, that the people who don't want this to happen, by this, I mean anything that starts to push responsibility back toward employers, A, and B, anything that starts to right the enormously tilted imbalance in the financial marketplace between individual workers, right, and financial services conglomerates, right? And if you think about what an IRA is, right, it's basically, you know, except on very bad days when you make a really big mistake as an employer, it's basically individual employees going toe-to-toe in a marketplace with, you know, with BlackRock and Vanguard and Fidelity. It's a little bit of a power imbalance there. And the people who benefit from these arrangements are not going to, are going to fight back against anything, right, that starts to push the other direction, right? And their time horizon is long-term, right? They understand that you start pushing a little bit, you push a little more, right? They're not going to let the toe in the camel's nose in the tent one little bit. They're going to fight, and they're going to fight anything. It's not going to be possible to negotiate that entire community into a position of acquiescence to anything, not just anything meaningful, but anything. All right. Now, you know, in the age of Eric Cantor, this shouldn't be a really surprising lesson for all of you. But the question is, so what does that mean? Is it hopeless? Is there nothing we can do? No, that's not the lesson. The lesson is that the question is, the key strategic question that faces all of you in contemplating what to do here is not the question of how do we water this thing down so that every single, you know, every single lobbyist and every single tall building on Park Avenue is okay with it. Right? That's not how this can get done. The question is, what are you going to put on the table that is going to motivate your base to fight for it? That's the question. Now, I'm not saying that in various kinds of end games there aren't compromises to be made. And John has gone through sort of how a lot of different sort of places people have ended up. That's not the point. The point is not what the end game is. The point is, where do you start? Right, how do you motivate people to believe this is a fight worth fighting for? Right. Now, I want to point out something, and then analytically about the nature of the landscape you're looking at. And I'm going to stop because they're waving the 1 minute sign at me. A really important thing to understand here is that there are these labels: defined contribution, defined benefit, Social Security, et cetera. Right? The labels kind of cover over, I don't mean they hide, but they kind of subsume a set of discrete characteristics. And John did a nice job with them. I'm going to list them in a somewhat different way, but it's the same set of characteristics, right? A, you got to have money. Money is the most important thing. But this is all just talk, right, without money. Now, it matters. In soft labor markets, it matters whether the money comes from the employer or the employee. You know, economists who never make it out of first-year economics will tell you it doesn't matter, but in a soft labor market, it does, right? But better get it come from the employee than it not come at all, right? So adequate funding is first. And it's got to be mandatory, I'm afraid. I think we know that if it's not mandatory, it's not going to be adequate. Secondly, annuitization and affordable annuitization, right? And annuitization covers within it the risk issues that John was talking about, market risk and age risk. These are risks individuals cannot afford to take, which the 401k system puts on them entirely. There's the issue of pooled management. A huge amount of money is lost because of the lack of pooled management, given that we're not going to beat the markets. Pooled management is enormously important. It's not just a sideshow or an issue of punishing Wall Street or anything like that. It's really important in terms of having the money at the end of the day. Probably 25% variation in overall retirement assets available, depending on whether or not you get pooled professional management or not. Then there's the question of portability. I think people all understand that, I think, at some level. Portability is really, really important. Portability not just between employers, but people may change careers, there's portability is important. And finally, the question John talked about, leakage and not allowing leakage. Now, you can put a hierarchy here in terms of how serious an effort you're making. Right? My RA, which is even less than auto IRA, which the Obama administration put in place, is like voluntary. Right? No one's being required to do anything. It's just like, here's this thing if you want to use it. right? There's no money, there's no pooled management. Well, there's sort of pooled management, it's all in treasury securities, but it doesn't lead to pooled management in any meaningful way. There's no annuitization, it's just a savings account, right? It's like saying, hey, if you can't find your way to a bank, here's an alternative. I mean, it doesn't do any harm. I'm sorry? It's narrower than that. That's Karen Feldman, the FLCIO's ERISA expert. All right. So I'm always understating the problems with these things. So you've got that at one level. You know, auto IRA, which I described earlier, right, is the next step up. You're actually mandating the employer to offer the account, but that's it. Right. From there, you can go to various things and various things and various things. But really, what are we really looking for? We're looking for a retirement security vehicle that is portable across everything, right? That is properly funded and on a mandatory basis. That provides cheap annuitization. That is cheap in terms of the asset management cost. That allows no leakage and is protects you against age risk and market risk and inflation risk. Now, this sounds like the Holy Grail. Right? It's not like, oh, how can we possibly, it's impossible, we could never find something that good. You know, it's just utopian to even think about it. Does anyone know what it is?
Yes, Social Security.
Well, it's Social Security. It's Social Security, right? I just described Social Security, right? It has all those features. It just is at a 30% income replacement rate rather than a higher one. And it turns out, by the way, that in the last year and a half, essentially the left wing of what exists in Washington, pushing the idea of expanding Social Security, has gotten more traction, right, in public life than 6 years of the Obama administration pushing for auto IRA. Mm-hmm. Right? It tells you something about the power of something that people understand and believe in. All right? Now, where do you want to end up? If Social Security is the gold standard, right? And you know, I believe that Steve talked about, you know, concepts for trying to replicate Social Security in whole or in part at the local level. If Social Security is the gold standard, you know, you can then sort of see where you fall on this gradation that goes down to essentially at the bottom, you know, these voluntary things. Political processes are, you know, contingent. You don't know where you're going to end up when you start. And as John laid out, a lot of people have ended up in a lot of different places. But you can measure how well you're doing by looking at the metrics I just defined. And I think that, you know, just to close here, it's really important at the National AFL-CIO that we do not reach down into places like New York City and tell folks exactly what to do. We just don't do that. This is the decision of the local labor movement, what to back, and local public officials as to what to do. Right? But we can tell you that we think that in New York right now, you have a kind of coming together, right, of a lot of different things, but in the political and in the economic sphere. You have a lot of unique resources here in this city, right? It's one of which you're sitting in, right? And you have an opportunity to do things that will be a model for other people, and you ought to do it. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Barbara Bowen, and I'm the president of the union that represents the faculty and staff at City University of New York. And I'm very pleased to be here, really honored to be in this company, and I also have several of our union members. So the issue that Damon raised so powerfully about motivating people to fight for something, I think we can talk about right here in this context. I'm not a pension expert. I want to get this out of the way first. I'm surrounded by pension scholars and experts. I'm not an economist. I often wish I were one. I'm an English professor, and finding myself in this world where pensions are a key part of what we must fight for if we're thinking about the economy, and that's why I'm here. And it's a very rare gathering today. I don't know if everybody sees that, but for one thing, to see younger people and older people together thinking about pensions, to see one of the leading scholars in the country, who's being very modest today, she actually should be on the panel, not moderating the panel, that's Teresa Ghilarducci, who really has defined a lot of the a lot of the scholarship and thinking about imagining pensions differently and understanding the flow of labor's capital, as she calls it. We have scholars here. We have leading policy people from our national unions and local unions. We have leading economists, and we have political officials who are committed to looking at financial stewardship. And we have a generation of students in the room, too. If we don't come out of today with something that we're going to do, I think it would be a tragedy. I think at the minimum, and I want to say why we should get to that, I am not going to offer a model like the ones that John did and try to present here a full-blown model for what to do with pensions in New York City or New York State. There are beautiful models out there, starting with Social Security. Teresa Ghilarducci has a model for expanding pensions. Levy Institute, Robin Blackburn in his wonderful book, Banking on Death. They all have models that need to be assessed and thought about, but thought about in a context of making them happen. I would like to propose that coming out of today, and we take the leadership of the center here, SEPA, and also the leadership of the Central Labor Council, whom I thank tremendously for getting this group of people in the room. That is a huge accomplishment. I hope that coming out of today, we can form at least a task force to start thinking about serious pension, not reform, but reimagination of pensions, and not just pensions, but retirement security in New York State and New York City. We have the largest union density in the country, the deepest density. If we do not come out of, in this state, with a proposal, or maybe this city, at a moment where we have a mayor who ran on a progressive platform, where we have a few years after Occupy Wall Street, which helped to redefine the issues that we heard about earlier from Dorian so powerfully, we are in a position, if anybody is, to rethink retirement security and do something. And shame on us in New York if we don't do that. So I hope that as we move into the discussion and question period, one of the things we can talk about is how to take a next step. Because as an organizer, I couldn't bear to leave this room with all of you here and not have the next step. And I was having all I could do earlier to stop myself from taking out a little sheet of paper and doing a sign-up sheet, a very low-tech way. And I thought Alex Gleason would kill me because he has done the organizing so beautifully and electronically. But I think there is a role for that sign-up sheet to say how many people in this room want to work on a retirement security solution in New York. The reason that I want to start really where Damon left us, the reason that we have to think big on pensions is one that he raised, that people will fight for a big idea where they often won't fight for a small idea. People, surveys show us, the history shows us, that people will come out for a strike who never would just sign a petition. There is something about the power of a big idea. Look at Occupy Wall Street, where people came for something they believed was very big and was going to change, not only change the discourse, which I think it did, but change the organization of society, which it hasn't done yet. But that will draw people more than come to my meeting to do this one improvement in my own benefit. It's not just that we have to think big because people want to be involved in something big if you're going to put your time in it, but also because pensions and the flow of that capital go right to the heart of the way we organize our economy and our society. Mike Davis, some of you know, he's a wonderful author of this book called Planet of Slums. He's also written a great book about Los Angeles. And he said, if Karl Marx were alive today, he would be in the British Library devouring everything he could find about pension funds, the new fuel of global capitalism. I think that's very important to think about, that pensions underlie that huge amount of money, even though not everyone has access to a pension. There are still trillions of dollars there. That huge amount of money underlies the whole world of finance, the whole world of profiteering, and it's labor's capital, as Ghilarducci has taught us. Robin Blackburn, who is also a powerful thinker about pensions, says, in fact, the boring world of pension provision now fuels the glamorous world of high finance, property speculation, rogue traders, media and technology mergers, and stock exchange bubbles. Pensions underlie the whole way we organize our economy because the profits from workers' work are taken away and used to create a high level of concentrated wealth for the very rich. That's what's happening with pension funds. They underlie much of the flow of capital in this society organized around capital. So number one, if we are thinking about changing retirement security and rethinking pensions, we have to think about the whole system that pensions support. And this is one reason why I agree with Damon that we shouldn't underestimate either the importance of this task or the resistance it's going to face, because it's so involved with the whole financial organization of our society and the funding of those vast flows of capital. On the other hand, pension and retirement security also go to the heart of who we are as people. And that's another reason that I think it's so important for us to think about this. When we think about retirement security, we're thinking about the relation between one generation and the next. And maybe as Mario Salento said this morning, really two generations on, when he talked about the pension of his grandfather helping to pay for the college education of his daughter. And here I think of something from Simone de Beauvoir. You wouldn't think of her maybe as a pension specialist, but she has a wonderful thing called from her presentation, Old Age, from 1977. She says, once we have understood what the state of the aged really is, we cannot satisfy ourselves with calling for more generous old age policy, higher pensions, decent housing, and organized leisure. It is the whole system which is at stake, and our claim cannot be otherwise than radical, to change life itself. Maybe we're not today going to form a task force to change life itself, but I think we should think about it. I think we should think about it because when she says that, she talks about a society that thinks about the relation of one person to another, thinks about that very human quality of commemorating ancestors. That, I think, goes to the heart of what we're thinking about when we think about how we take care of the next generation. The life expectancy in industrial countries changed in the most dramatic way in history over the last two centuries. At the beginning of the 19th century, life expectancy in Britain was 40 years, 40. It's now 77 years. It's almost doubled. Almost doubled. That, in a sense, has redefined who we are if our lives are almost twice as long as they used to be 200 years ago. So for the whole period that most of us have studied and recorded history, the whole concept of a life was completely different from now. And one thing that happened as the owners of wealth, and Damon talked about this, began to see that shift in the population, and we heard earlier about the ratio of workers to retirees. One thing that happened opportunistically was that the pension industry shifted the risk onto individuals as the population as the age of the population grew. And that shift, as we also heard earlier, was racialized and gendered. The way that retirement security does not work is not only involved with the whole giant flow of capital, but it is also deeply racialized and gendered. And that's why any solution to it is going to have to take on the biggest questions. We cannot be satisfied. I agree, we may not end up with a revision of life, as Simone de Beauvoir said. We may not end up where we started. But for us not to recognize what's at stake in pensions and how much of the whole rhythm of capital they underlie and fuel, how they help to transfer wealth, not back to the workers, but into the hands of the very wealthy already. If we don't take account of that, then we will not be looking at an adequate solution. If we don't also think about the way that transferring risk onto individuals is not gender neutral, Women are far less likely to succeed in an environment where there's individual risk. It's not racially neutral. People of color do much less well in that system. I think we have to look at how the way that pensions have been remade and all the risk for those even who have them has been transferred to individuals has also deepened the existing social, racial, gender, economic inequalities. So I would see that we don't want to take too much time, but I just want to mention two things. One is that we need to build on the work that has already been done in this area. And one thing I brought today is a little show and tell. Our union has a group, and some of them are here, I'm very proud to say, that's put out a booklet called Defending the Social Safety Net, and it has comes with a little flyer that says, steal this book. So I'm going to leave some up here for you. Hope some of you will steal this book. I hope that there will be a day when we are not only defending a social safety net, but expanding a social safety net. And I think that's the task in front of us. For labor, this is also the key task. The labor movement has been strongest and also proudest when we have understood our purview, not just as the people we represent in our unions, but as the whole of working people. Imagine if when we had fought for the 8-hour day, what we ended up with was only the 13% of people in unions having the 8-hour day and the rest of the population having totally unregulated workday. Or if only the 13% of people in unions, or whatever it is now, 6% in public sector unions, if only we had a weekend. You've probably all seen the bumper sticker, the labor movement, the folks who brought you the weekend, brought you, not just brought themselves the weekend, but brought us all the weekend. The labor movement is, first of all, at its strongest ethically and morally, but also politically, when we take our charge as not just fighting to defend our own pensions, but expanding and rethinking retirement security for everyone. Yes, we will do best defending what we have if we're not in a sea where everyone else does not have pensions. I mean, we often hear, well, you can't fight for retirement security for all because you risk losing the very good defined benefit plan you have. Just as many people when the Affordable Care Act came in said, well, the unions will be afraid of the Affordable Care Act because some of their benefits are better than what would be in the Affordable Care Act. I hope we learn from that process that the way to do reform is not to invest more in the profit-making centers that have already depleted workers' savings. The way is not to invest in the private sector, it's to find a public and shared solution that will bring real retirement security to everyone, not just to a few. So what I would call for, and I really look to the organizers of today's event to give us some guidance, but I hope that we find a way of not leaving this room today without taking advantage of the incredible brain trust in this space to form a working group to start thinking very big about solutions that we can start in New York. Maybe they'll grow, but solutions that don't shirk the deep implications of reorganizing the flow of saved monies, workers' capital, labor's capital, that don't neglect the racialized and gendered aspects of this economic inequality, that don't hide from the fact that this is a critical, that retirement security is one of the things that should define us as a culture. I mean, we started this morning with Professor Ghilarducci talking about civilized cultures, that retirement security should be a bedrock of such cultures. It should not be normalized that the aged or the older are poor. We have normalized poverty in this culture. We have a quarter of children in poverty and a substantial percentage of people here will know of the elderly in poverty. Why is that acceptable? We have to stop normalizing poverty and creating a situation where people have some kind of income only when they are useful to profit making. Otherwise, when they're too young or too old, they are no longer generating profit and therefore we accept poverty. So it should not be a mark of this, in this rich country, in this rich city, one of the richest in the world, that we tolerate the normalization of poverty for so many people. So I would hope that we could take some guidance, maybe Vinny will say something, or Teresa later on, about how we might actually form a task force to build on what we've learned today, which is a tremendous amount, to have a very high horizon, a very ambitious goal, not of starting by fitting in, well, what do we think we can get past, but think of what we really want, and understanding that labor will be strongest when we take the most expansive vision. That's when we have been strongest, when we imagine life differently, because that's really what the labor movement initially was about and could be about again, is imagining life differently. And almost nothing is as important as retirement security. Almost nothing is as important as the way one generation invests money so that in their own old age or for the next, there is some sense of a life that is fulfilling and not a life that is simply about use value by capital. So I would like to end by asking how many people here would be willing to work, not necessarily to be a task force, but because I don't want to take away that sense of organizing it that others will have, but I'd like to ask how many people here would be willing to work for a reform and a reform of retirement security and old age security in New York City and New York State. How many people here would be willing to work on that? All right, so, okay, that's good. That's good. Wait, let's keep them up for a minute. We have a lot of photographers here. We should. You will be recorded. We will come back to you. Okay, that's a lot of people.
Dana's gonna get you.
Okay, that's a lot of people. And I look forward to working with you. I certainly don't have the solutions myself, but I do have a sense that pension goes far beyond a question of one's narrow savings. It goes far beyond individual issues. It goes to the heart of how we organize our society and how we think about ourselves as people. And we have a chance in New York State and New York City to make a real difference. And I think we should have been doing it already, but there's a real chance here. And right now, I think, is the year to do it and not think small, but to think big. So I hope that we do that. And I look forward to doing that and learning from you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Barbara, for that consolidation, bringing it back to where we started when we opened this up. I know you're all here because you've already signed up to work for retirement security for all Americans. I really want to tell you what we're up against. As Damon said, as Barbara said, as John has lived, we are up against an attack on workers' retirement. Not only our retirement, but over the past 40 years, all the longevity gains. We've all heard about everybody's living longer, not true. The longevity gains have gone to the highest income, the wealthiest among us. And they're the ones that have most of the retirement wealth. 79% of the tax breaks for retirement income security go to the top 20%. That's $150 billion. Go to people who are living the longest, have the most wealth, the highest rate of return in their professionally managed pensions. They're getting the most help, the people who need it the least. That's why John has probably mentioned something concrete that we could all get behind, is equitable tax reform and a refundable tax credit so that everybody gets some help for saving for their retirement. But we also gathered here to actually agree upon something else, and I just want to bring it up. We want to stop the attack on retirement, because you know what the prevailing solution to the retirement crisis is? Even among our friends in the North at Boston College, Alicia Minnell, she has written a book with a solution. And it's not the solution we're talking about here. She and my other colleagues in the economics profession has said, I've got the solution. y'all will just work a little longer. But you know what this center has discovered? Not the one at Boston College. Is that in the past 10 years, the jobs that people over 55 have are not getting easier because of the computer and because of the beneficence of work of employers who have been hemmed in by stronger worker occupational laws. No, the jobs of 55-year-olds have now are worse than they were 15 years ago. They require more stooping and bending, more keen eyesight, intense concentration, more monitoring, because the labor movement has been weakened, and because the agenda in this country is to get everybody to work. The children, people who've worked at home taking care of people doing care labor, and now older people. That's the agenda in America. We're unlike any other country that allows money to be taken out before retirement, to be taken out in lump sums, and to allow everybody to work in part-time, very low-paid jobs. And so what's at stake today and why we have the people in the room, the labor movement that can stop it, is that we did fight hard for the weekend, and we fought hard for everybody to have a strong Social Security system and expanded defined benefit plans. But just like they're trying to take away the weekend, they're trying to take away retirement security with our longer lives and with our pensions. So we're here to stop the end of retirement and to protect retirement for all Americans. And we're going to start here. Damon, thanks for the call to action. Mm-hmm. And Barbara for punching that out. And for John to do it state by state, city by city. We have to do it at the local level because controllers, city controllers, are going to have to pay the price. It's not the federal government. It's going to be our mayors and our state controllers who are going to have to feed the elderly who are in a chronic state of deprivation and boost up the economies that have a very impoverished elderly population. So that's why we're here today. We'll fashion our state solution. Thanks to Comptroller Scott Stringer for calling together a task force. That's what we'll organize. And please look to us for the research and the data and the policy briefs that will speak to that agenda, to stop the end of retirement and secure retirement for all New Yorkers and all Americans. So I'd like to open it up for your short questions and let the conversation here in New York begin. Anyone like to emphasize a point, sir?
One of the things that's really changed in the economy.
Okay. One of the things
a question too, please.
Yeah, one of the things that's really changed in the economy in the last, you know, 10, 20 years is the amount of part-time, freelance, casual, precarious work. I know that Barbara knows that with all the adjuncts they have in universities now. So what kind of changes can you make to ensure retirement security for people like that? Because, you know, those are the people who are among the least likely to have anything even remotely resembling a pension.
Well, that's what we're struggling for. John, do you want to speak to that?
I mean,
we started
you know,
in California.
Right. I mean, the idea would be that, you know, the reality is you want to make these plans so that anybody or everybody really is a participant. And so even if you're a casual or a contingent worker, you would still ideally have both an employee contribution and an employer contribution, even if it's not regular, you know, a regular full-time or permanent job. Again, I do think that we need to struggle. I mean, there's also a lot of people who are unemployed. We have a huge problem with chronic unemployment now, right, where people have left the labor force. Are they, you know, we often talk, I mean, our regular kind of rhetoric is about being able to retire in dignity after a lifetime of hard work. The truth is, in this economy, not everybody can even work their entire lives because there aren't enough jobs there, right? And so honestly, we need to be innovative in trying to figure out how, because as Damon said, the problem with retirement starts with money. You got to get money into the system. And the truth is that if there were contributions made, as there are in Social Security, for every worker from the moment they start working until the moment they stop working, if we had adequate contributions into a either a beefed up Social Security system or into a universal supplemental system, we could solve the problem. Whether you're a contingent worker or whether you're a regular full-time worker. But we don't have that. How do we get from here to there is really the problem that we're all trying to address.
Can I just add one thing about this? I think there is, I don't have any problem with what John just said, but I think there's an additional thing it's really important to understand about this question of various kinds of precarious work and how it relates to retirement security, which is this, that, as John said, the Social Security system is designed better than anything else we've got to deal with this issue, because it picks up income, it picks up wage income of all kinds, including independent contractor income and the like. It's got a gap, which is that it doesn't pick up income to capital, right? And this is why it's underfunded, really, because there's been a shift in our economy from return to labor to return to capital. If we had the same ratio of returns to capital and returns to labor as we had in 1983, when Social Security was last reformed, Social Security wouldn't have a deficit, right? But Social Security is the best mechanism that we have in our world right now for dealing with your problem, with the issue you raise. And it's also true that traditional single employer defined benefit plans, multi-employer plans are pretty good at this as long as people are staying in the same industry. Traditional single employer plans, not so good, because employers didn't want them to be good at this. They wanted them to lock people into their jobs. The idea that the DC system is better is a myth because of the leakage issue. And you can see that in the data that's been produced, I think, and handed out in this conference, in terms of the actual assets available to people in this city today, depending on whether they've got a DC or a DB plan. And you'll see that in a world of mobile people and people changing jobs and all that, it's still the case that DB plans produce a much better retirement. Even given DB plans' problems, they produce a much better outcome in the kind of contingent world we live in. Because of the leakage problem on the DC side, and because, as John said, there's no money on the DC side.
I think that this meeting is probably the best news I've heard in this area in years and years and years. Teresa has been fighting this fight for so many years, attempting to get the federal government to set up a secondary Social Security system, switching to trying to get the states to set this up. So hopefully we'll have some great movement from here. I want to tell you how I describe what's going on. I describe what's going on comparing this retirement inequality with the following. Standing on line at a bus stop, all of a sudden it starts to rain. One person on that line has an umbrella. That person opens the umbrella and is protected. The other people on line have two thoughts. Some of them say, I too wish I had an umbrella. And some of them say, let's take that umbrella away from that person and so that he has no protection. I think that the role of what we're going to do in the future is we have to take that group that says, take the umbrella away from the person that has it and change them so that they too say, I wish that I had this kind of a protection. And I think that is something that we should all be working on. I agree with Barbara in that we have to move on from here. Hopefully, Comptroller Stringer's committee will set up in the fall and will start to lead us. Or we may have to get our own and do it ourselves. But one thing we have to do is we have to change the thinking of those people who say those that have retirement security shouldn't have it into those that don't have retirement security should have it.
With apologies to Sigmund Freud, I've coined the term pension envy to describe the campaign that started with Grover Norquist 15 years ago that wanted to weaken the Democratic Party by weakening unions and by going after what unions have accomplished, which is retirement security for public sector members. And we've seen the campaign. And I don't know when kindergarten teachers or janitors became public enemy number one, but even the New York plan that has been well funded, it stayed well funded during the crisis, and most others, you just have to know this. When you look at the 170 public pension plans in the country, the major ones, and there's actually 2,000 of them, and you look at the ones that fell below 70% funded during the worst financial crisis that none of the biggest brains on Wall Street ever predicted, that fell below it, only a handful fell below any kind of dangerous level. The New York State stayed at a very healthy level, and I'm hearing from experts that it's the unions that cause it to be in peril. They use numbers like, did you know that right now there is going to be a ratio of 3 workers to every retiree, as if somehow demographics were destiny? Did you actually know that in the 1960s, there were one worker supporting many children? We're all here. We were all born. There were 3 children to every family. We have systems in place, as Damon talked about, Social Security, defined benefits that sit on top of that, that actually can foresee financial crisis, foresee demographic. It's all there, ready in a technical bundle. What's not there is a effective resistance, and we're starting it here. We're consolidating now with people who want to take away your retirement. Don't let them say that just because one person is healthy and the other have the flu, that we should all get sick. Another, to extend the metaphor, the umbrella metaphor. So I see public sector workers here in this room, and I see private sector workers here in this room, and I see young people, our students in this room who are going to be either private or public sector. We are now, by standing here, standing together to protect retirement income security. Thank you, Mel. It was great metaphors. Anybody else? Brother with a hat.
So first, I want to thank the organizers for this very, very informative get-together. Two things. In the 1930s, when a lot of the safety net, so-called safety net that we had in this country came into existence, there were two things that were prevalent, I would say. One was a lot of struggle. I always think to the quote, I'll just paraphrase because I never get quotes right, of Frederick Douglass, without struggle, there is no progress. And the second, I think that in terms of any kind of paradigm that we want to talk about in terms of whether it's retirement security or getting away from this rich get richer paradigm that we have here with 1% or the 0.01% or whatever it is that controls this country is profiting superly, just to an enormous extent. If we're going to get away from that paradigm, there has to be struggle. And the second thing is to just piggyback on what Barbara Bowen had spoken about, that we have to have an imagination that says that this society does not have to be organized in exactly the same way that it is today. And in the 1930s, there was that kind of view. Some people might disagree with what was the main thought that was going on then, which was the threat of communism, which was, I have a question. I have a question. But I think that a lot of the legislation and changes of the 1930s were in response to struggle and of the threat of people being won to a different view of the world. And I just would like our panelists, if they could comment on how we could perhaps increase the level of struggle and also comment on this question of view. Thank you.
Thank you. I know it's coming up to the lunch hour, but we have Tish James was about ready to walk in this door. That's what I wanted to say. So the last word for the panel, and when she walks in, she'll take the stage.
Okay. On struggle, I think you're absolutely right. We heard Steve Kreisberg say earlier that this society has created insecurity by the personal savings approach. And Damon also talked about the way that the current situation is the result of policies, right? The result of policy decisions. We heard about Grover Norquist and one policy decision over the next. It is not like a natural evolution. So we start there, and I think you're absolutely right that it will not be overturned without struggle. We shouldn't underestimate the depth of the of this whole organization of capital, which is based on the current system funded by workers' pensions and that profit going into the richest in the society. There's going to be huge resistance. And I think the point you were making, that struggle for individual reforms in the 30s was against the backdrop of a larger revolutionary struggle that helped make those reforms possible, is a powerful point. And it's something that we're not going to create in this room, but I think it's worth remembering that there were revolutionary struggles that helped to give birth to a reform. Social Security is a reform, a huge one, but I think you're right in pointing to that relationship. So labor has to think hard and be imaginative if we are going to conquer something as fundamental as the current organization of people's lives, designed to create people who are insecure, underemployed, unemployed, and not resistant members of a society.
And Damon Silvers.
Yeah. So look, this question is, I think, responding to Barbara's admonition to sort of expand the vision a little bit. It goes well beyond pensions. It gives me an opportunity to say a couple of things that I think are really, really important in terms of where the labor movement is going and where American society is going. The first is that the fundamental challenge, in the view of the AFL-CIO, the fundamental challenge that we face in America today in addressing the fact that we have been on the wrong path as a society for a generation around economics. Right? There are many respects in which America is a far better place today than it was 30 or 40 years ago. Right? There's lots of ways in which we are a more humane and tolerant society. But on the core economic questions, we have gone dramatically in the wrong direction. And at the heart of that, right, and perhaps this is what the question meant about struggle, at the heart of that is fundamentally the loss of confidence on the part of working people they can do anything about it. Right? And everything that we do as organizers has got to be about restoring that confidence. Right? That when working people, in a typical American workplace in the 1960s, particularly in a typical American industrial workplace, there were people who knew, right, that they could stop everything in its tracks if they chose to. Right? That they had done it before, and they would do it again if called upon. Right? There was a sense of power that working people had because of what they had been through collectively over the previous generation. And what we have today is a legacy of defeat, and we must transform that to something different. Right? And very little is going to happen, I'm afraid, until we make progress in that direction. But let me tell you something. I think compared with 5 years ago, I can point to example after example of progress being made in that direction. Progress, much of which began here in New York City, right? Progress around with fast food workers, and progress at Walmart, and progress at taxi drivers, and progress day laborers. There is movement in this direction, but it is just the beginning. And the second thing I want to say about it is about imagination. All right. You know, I was recently in Europe, and I was at the American Embassy in Prague, and I was asked by the embassy staff, what is it with this guy Piketty? Is it really true that a French Marxist intellectual is the number one author in America? How can that be true? And I said, well, I said, I don't know. I said, I think it's evidence of how deep, how serious a wrong turn we've made as a society that we're willing to listen to this particular type of prophet in telling us where we stand. But I also said to them, I think there's a real problem with the way that Piketty looks at this. And this relates to this question of imagination. That Piketty tells us that modern capitalism is a kind of is kind of only got one gear, and it's toward inequality, right? That this is sort of baked in some sort of profound, systemic, universal, this is the kind of thing that, you know, French intellectuals like to imagine, right? That, but at the end of the day, you ask yourself, well, okay, how do we change that? Right? And I think that whole way of thinking is just wrong. I don't think history works that way at all. I think that the way a society is a matter of choice. It's a matter of choice by, in some respects, all members of our society, of any given society, the choice of whether to act or not to act. There's a lot more responsibility, honestly, that rests on elites. And America's elites in the last generation have failed our society in profound ways. And in my opinion, no more profound and tragically and indefensibly than in relation to economics and finance in the last 5 years. But these things can be changed. They are within our power to change and within our ability to imagine and make real something different. And that is the entire lesson of everything that has happened in the cause of working people and in the labor movement for the last 300 years. We better not forget it.
Yeah, hear, hear. Well, we're all here because we have a call to be a public advocate, but only one person has that official title in New York City, and that's Tish James, our public advocate, newly elected. She is a graduate of Howard University Law School. We have another graduate from Howard University here today, one of our new RAs. And more importantly, she was raised in Brooklyn. Thank you very much, Tish. Very much.
So first, good afternoon. I want to thank Vinny Alvarez and, of course, my good friend, New York State Comptroller Tom DiNapoli. I want to thank all of you for having me here today. We must credit Teresa, and I hope I don't mispronounce your name, Ghilarducci. Ah. I grew up in an Italian neighborhood in Brooklyn, so I'm really good. So we must credit her for all her hard work and her expertise. When so many businesses and market watchers and academics and members of the media couldn't see the economic collapse of 2008 on the horizon, Teresa was already talking about the next and more powerful storm. She was a voice in the wilderness years ago, trying to draw our attention to this impending crisis. Well, she has succeeded, and now we must build on her hard work and turn our objectives into realities for all workers, whose ranks are about to swell into tens of millions of baby boomers, including myself, approaching retirement age. The Great Recession, from which we are still recovering, a recession that dramatically altered all of our lives and changed how we saved and spend. It was just a mere appetizer compared to what may be approaching in the next two decades. The fact is that a daunting majority of Americans within a stone's throw of retirement age are wholly and completely unprepared for their retirement, unprepared for the storm. We are here for an honest and open conversation about the future of retirement in New York State and indeed the United States. We are here because we can all agree that every American, every New Yorker deserves a safe, secure retirement. All of those New Yorkers that we spoke of during our campaign, all of those New Yorkers who represent the Tale of Two Cities. We are gathered here under one roof today, leaders from the business and investment community, academics, students, labor leaders, people from the nonprofit sector, and those of us in city and state government. We're here because we recognize the crisis and we seek a solution. The single most important thing we can do when we leave today is to begin to put an end to kick the can down the road mentality. Someone else's problem, the next administration. That sort of willful denial is precisely what's put us in this place. And as a public advocate, I believe in taking on bold and difficult discussions, even if they hurt. From a government perspective, increased collective investment serves two purposes. First, of course, it increases the investment power for each and every dollar that participates that our participants put back into the system. And second, it reduces the burden on future city and state budgets to provide services for seniors. Every dollar a person puts away for retirement is one less dollar government as the final guarantor will have to spend in the future. If we convince, compel, or I dare say coerce people into saving, then that saves taxpayer money that can be used instead for infrastructure, affordable housing, education, public works, improving mass transportation, creating jobs, union jobs. And when we look at the numbers, the problem is clear. Let's start with some of the facts. The percentage of workers in the New York region who have any type of retirement plan, traditional or a 401k plan, is falling steadily. The number has fallen from 49% to 41% between 2002 and 2012. That is 10 points lower than the national average during the same period. The 401k is not the answer. Let me say that again. The 401k is not the answer. It failed to replace the qualities of good pensions. More than $150,000 is lost over a working couple's lifetime in 401k fees, according to Demos. And today, half of all workers in the New York metro area have no retirement plan at all. Half of all workers have no retirement plan. The Great Recession forced countless Americans into retirement Russian roulette, forced to withdraw their retirement savings to meet their immediate needs after losing a job or going underwater on their mortgages, or in some cases trying to prevent their homes from going into foreclosure. Some people were forced to put significant amounts of money out of their savings in order to pay for their children's education or deal with the difficulty of unexpected medical condition or divorce, which has caused the feminization of poverty, not only in our state, but in this country. Needless to say, responsible people tap their savings and are unable to replenish those retirement dollars. Most of us have heard of the three-legged stool analogy. That was so common in financial planning of yesteryear, that as we prepared for retirement, we could rely on Social Security, employee pensions, and our savings. Well, sad to say that three-legged stool isn't working anymore and needs critical care. I'll say it again, everyone deserves a safe and a secure retirement. Right now, 40% of near retirement households, those between the ages of 55 through 64 in the metropolitan area, have total liquid assets of less than $10,000. And we know our young people are not saving either. When we look at New Yorkers between 25 and 64, this percentage increases to 44% when adding those younger Americans to the mix. And we all know a lot of them are trying to stay alive, just trying to pay, you know, tuition fees and paying back student loans. Both the participation rate and the sponsorship rate of pensions in New York have been on the decline since 1989, decline with the labor movement. And we have consistently trailed the national average. And for young adults, how does a person put money away for retirement when they are over their heads in college debt, as I just mentioned, and the cost of a rental in New York City? Well, you know, try to find an affordable housing anywhere around here or anywhere in Manhattan and even downtown Brooklyn. A storm is coming. And we know that the scope and intensity will be strong, and we know that we can take steps to mitigate the damage. There's gloom and doom on the horizon, but we can change the narrative, all of us in this room. We can motivate fellow New Yorkers, and we can impart the sense of urgency on people in government. Since the federal government isn't leading, we can take the initiative and lead here in New York City. We can change course. The roadmap starts with one important step. We must preserve what currently exists, and that includes stopping those who want to do away with defined benefit plans for public workers. And it means we must create new vehicles for those in the private sector to save. Again, preserve what we have for public workers, create new vehicles for those in the private sector to save. And specifically, I'm talking about a pension system for private employees, akin to the system provided for public sector workers. Let that set in for a moment. Something revolutionary. A pension system for private employees, something similar to what I enjoy and what our great attorney, what our controller enjoys, and our controller for public sector employees. We cannot afford to lose ground or allow those who are secure to slip into the downward spiral. There was a quote by MTA after Sandy. It said, fix and fortify, so I'm going to borrow that. Let's fix and let's fortify. We need education, outreach, and communication, and particularly communication that's culturally sensitive, that spans every media platform and multiple languages. The facts are alarming. Half of all workers in the New York City metropolitan area have no retirement plan at work. 51% of women do not have access to a plan. 51% of women. 57% of African Americans. 50% of Asians. 57% of Latinos. 33% of workers between the ages of 25 and 44 do not have access to a plan. 52% of private sector workers. 61% of individuals at firms of less than 51 employees do not have a pension. 72% of employees who earn less than $30,000 are out there on a ship all alone. So we must engage these groups and prepare them for retirement. We must create a centrally pooled retirement fund for private sector workers. And as I think about the difference of having a pension and no pension up close, I think about my own family. My mother worked for AT&T when they were unionized, and she had a pension which allowed me to go to Howard University School of Law. And while I was at Howard University School of Law, my father, who worked as a porter before 32BJ organized the workers, did not have a pension. And in my second year of law school, he died. He died before they were unionized, and he died because he did not have health insurance and or a pension, and he worked every day, notwithstanding the fact that he had diabetes. He missed his appointments. He missed his dialysis appointments. He worked every day. And then one day, on Dr. King's birthday, my second year of law school, my mother called me to say that he had died. A pension and a union obviously would have helped my father and would have allowed him to see his little girl become the first African-American woman elected citywide, but that was not the case. A fund would have allowed him to lower management costs and would provide better returns than a traditional 401 and would provide him with health insurance. And a fund would also benefit small business owners and create a competitive advantage for New York-based businesses. Based on the 2011 NYPERS report, small business owners overwhelmingly support the concept of a retirement plan. A plan modeled on the public pension system that would offer a guaranteed monthly pension benefit. Nearly 7 out of 10 small businesses owners are interested in a retirement plan for their own businesses. Now, of course, they're all concerned about the details, but that's really up to all of you in this room. It includes a small majority of small business owners who do not currently provide any retirement benefits to their employees. Almost all small business owners agree that offering a retirement benefit helps to recruit good employees. You know how you force political solutions, how you get people in power to listen? It starts with the letter writing and the emails. It starts with the media coverage and the editorial board. It starts with the demonstration and rallies. It starts with us going back to our constituents and ringing the carrion bell. The future is bleak only if we allow it to be bleak. But it must begin with a discussion. We can change course, stop our trajectory, and ensure that the next generation of seniors live with dignity. We are not powerless and we are not divided. Look around this room. We are here for a common goal. We are building coalitions of groups that sometimes don't always get along. The business community, academics, labor, not-profits, government, politicians, I even see a preacher in the room, because we know our collective future is at stake. And when we tune into the weather forecast on TV and we see a dangerous storm coming our way, we shouldn't bury our heads in the sand and ignore the problem. We should devise a plan of action, take decisive measures, protect what we have, make a plan for the future, because now is the time to stop this retirement storm. The clouds are forming, and it will be here before we know it. And hopefully we can stop a little girl from seeing her father die. Every New Yorker and every American deserves a safe and a secure retirement. Our economy depends on it, and it depends upon all of you in this room. I thank you.
And now President Alvarez will say goodbye and close our gathering.
And if I can, you know, we're winding this down. We've been here for almost 4 hours, and there's a side of me that wants to say, okay, Alvarez, what you get yourself into? But I want to begin with thanking, of course, SIPA and Teresa Ghilarducci for a phenomenal day. Thank you to our public advocate, and thank you to our controller, Tom DiNapoli. The commitment that our elected officials have towards the labor movement, to working people in the city, all working people, it really warms the heart when we get into serious discussions like this, and from the bottom of all of our hearts in organized labor, and we look forward to seeing you throughout the summer and at your reelection, of course, and working with you for many years, Tom, and in the months and the years ahead. I think just a couple quick closing thoughts. You know, a lot of these policy institutes and discussions that ensue throughout the country are led by think tanks. And I think we really have to make sure that we don't just fall into the trap of working with think tanks, but become a think and act tank here in the New York City labor movement when we talk about this. And I think that it's very important for us, as our panelists, who did a phenomenal job, their intelligence and their commitment to working people, I think, really came through, and I thank all of them for being here. But it's really very important for us to remember how they all, in very different ways, but articulated what it is that we are up against. We did not get here by accident. And anybody who's spent some time reading the Powell memo 40 years ago now, just about, or has studied these issues, understands that this was very carefully planned out evolution to people of extraordinary wealth and power over the past 4 or 5 decades in this country. So I think that as we go and talk about solutions to the crisis of retirement security, we need to keep that at the forefront of our minds, so this way we know what we are up against as we move forward in these discussions. The labor movement, as Damon Silvers, our policy director for the national AFL-CIO, articulated so strongly, will be and needs to be at the forefront of these discussions, since they affect all working people. It is critical. We need to be out there. We need to be in these discussions. And we need to start, at first and foremost, to recognize that there is the obvious correlation between the decline of worker power in this country and the labor movement and the conditions that everyday working people throughout this country face today, the diminished conditions that each one of them faces, and the increased expectations of individually how they are going to fund their own retirement in a way that hopefully can provide them with a meaningful and dignified life in the twilight of their years. We need to focus on defending collective bargaining at every corner that we have this discussion, and to protect and preserve and extend the Social Security system, because it has been so important, and we need to make sure that those are at the forefront of these discussions when we talk about additional options in the weeks, in the months, in the years ahead with a new administration. You know, New York City is a city and a state where big things happen. People look to us as a beacon for hope, and we need to be hopeful. But what good is it if we elect officials to office in New York City? And what good is it if we say that we're 1 in 4 workers are unionized in New York City and in New York State, and we have the highest union density in the country, if we don't do something about it in a way which leads to discussion throughout this country? in a way that's going to help lift up all working people. So I would just say this, you know, sometimes in closing, and sometimes we don't know exactly what corner it is that we're going to, what's around the corner that we're going around, or on the other side of the hill that we're going over, and we should not let that fear sometimes pause us into inaction, because this current condition and this, when it comes to retirement security, it is a model that we cannot sustain in our cities and states throughout this country. We need to act. We need to get together. We need to not be fearful of the discussion, and we need to make sure that we do it in a broad and inclusive way, which I think today we began that first step. So I want to thank everybody, and I look forward to participating on the many. I think we had 3 or 4 or 5 panels that were introduced or discussed with concepts from elected officials and others, and we will be hearing, obviously, from the New York City Central Labor Council and the AFL-CIO moving forward, and we look forward to leading this discussion and ending this and stopping this crisis from becoming any worse than it is, the crisis of retirement security here in New York City. So thank you all for coming, and we look forward to working in the future.